All right, let's get this party started. Hey everyone, thank you for coming in. Welcome to the first Force Unleashed developer commentary, because you are in fact a dev, aren't you?
As are you.
I'm with David Collins.
Hi everybody.
And we are hanging out here in an undisclosed location, and I'm gonna drive.
Yes.
I'm gonna play Force Unleashed, and we're going to talk about our remembrances in making this game. And ideally what will be happening is every now and then we will do this again, and we already have other developers from the game who want to join us. So we're going to have some really nice guests on here, either via, you know, either live or over Skype.
Mm-hmm. By the way, it never gets old watching you play this game. I remember the first time that we finally got a milestone in where your likeness was actually in the game and playing.
I remember this.
And you came and you flew up. I don't know if it was for VO pickups or what, but you flew in and you were playing the game. And I just had this moment watching you play as Starkiller, like you're literally driving your own avatar. That was pretty insane. The whole thing is really insane. The whole Force Unleashed.
Well, how did
story.
It start? Like, when was the first time you were aware of?
The first time I was really aware of.
By the way, what should I play? Sith, do we want to just get through it, or do we want to challenge?
I don't know. Twitch.
We'll go to Sith Master. Let's go to
Twitch. Twitch. What is he? What I've got the comments here. What should he play? How? What difficulty?
What difficulty? There's a little bit of a lag, so I'm going to answer this.
But yeah, it was 2005. Really, when I remember the Force Unleashed.
2005. So you were 14 years old.
I was 14, yes, in 2005. No. We had just finished Battlefront 2, and Revenge of the Sith had just come out on DVD at the time.
So Sith Lord.
Oh, Sith Lord. Sith we'll Lord. Never get through it. Sith Lord is
well,
good.
It's better than Sith Master.
Yeah,
Sith Master
yeah.
would be in trouble, but do you believe in me? I believe
Let's
in me.
Test the Sam Witwer,
Let's
because I think you'll do very well knowing you on this game. So, opening cinematic. Yeah. Boy, oh boy. Yeah, title crawl here. Feels like Star Wars. So yeah, 2005, George was kind of quietly, you know, using finger quotes here, retiring.
Retiring.
But he
in
wasn't. He was.
You know,
yeah, yeah.
The movies, episode 3 had just come out in 2005.
It had just come out, and so Jim Ward had become president of LucasArts, and he was, you know, he very smartly kind of just did a real big brand audit or brand survey. Well, what should we do and just really blow out a really big Star Wars video game? What do people want out of Star Wars? They want the hero's journey. They want something epic. They want something meaningful, you know, because before that, we had put out just a slew of Star Wars games, you know, and so he set about with Hayden Blackman, the project lead, like really coming up with, and Peter Hirschman, the vice president, coming up with an idea for how Star Wars would look on sort of the next generation of consoles and what was the future of LucasArts, and is LucasArts going to be the driving engine? We knew nothing about the Clone Wars at the time. It was still so early.
And it was secret.
It was very, very secretive, yeah. So we were just very much, you know, very excited about it. And he had this idea of unleashing the Force. And the thing about the Force Unleashed is it was...
Hold on, I'm going to adjust the audio.
Oh, is it...
We should be all right. We should be okay.
Hearing things okay? Oh,
yeah,
okay.
I can adjust it in the game as well, so... Yeah, anyway, keep going.
Well, so, yeah, the early demos were very sort of tech-driven, and before there was really a story, I know Hayden pitched a lot of stuff to George Lucas.
Including a Wookiee game.
Including a Wookiee game.
He pitched a Wookiee game.
But eventually this idea of giving Darth Vader a secret apprentice, who, by the way, had no name at the time.
No.
He was not Starkiller. It's funny, we'll get to the Starkiller story later, but, man, these opening cinematics. I mean, besides making
Marty Stoltz directed these opening cinematics.
He did it incredible.
Yeah, and he did it with no time. We didn't have any time to do this, correct?
Well, yeah, just in general, just to kind of frame The Force Unleashed, I mean, I just remember this was one of those experiences in life where, like, if you can do that, you can really, you know, you feel like, if I could survive this, I can do anything, because it was so hard. New engine, new team, new story, new consoles, and, I mean, just new everything, you know, just building everything from scratch, which, for those of you who know a lot about game development, I mean, it's... Most big franchise games are built upon something that came before it, you know, like
Lord Vader,
the biggest
we were ambushed
Grand
upon
Theft Auto,
arrival,
first
but
really
I
big
have
three,
the situation
right?
well
you know,
in...
Blizzard's a great example. DICE
no
is a great example.
In your feelings.
This actor Gerrion Munroe, Darren, that's his likeness. I think I played with him in 2006.
Did he do the voice and...
He did the voice and that was his likeness.
A lot of the actors in here were not only just the likeness, but they're also the voice.
Yeah.
Which is interesting. Let me just really quick adjust this. All right. I think that should help a little bit.
Is that better? Volume was too loud there?
Yeah, it was a little bit too loud. I think I just knocked it down a little bit. Anyway.
Starting the game is Darth Vader.
That's right. That's right. And I love all this background information. The Siege of...
The Siege of Kashyyyk.
Yeah.
Or Kashyyyk is what Coleman called it.
Kashyyyk. Kashyyyk.
Yeah, turning it down just a little bit more.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
just
cool.
Making sure. Yeah. But it's fun to see all this detail. And Kashyyyk was this, you know, amazing place that we saw in episode 3, and now we're revisiting it. And it's still beautiful, which is something to be noted at the beginning of the story. And then also, you know, I love that the art director, they took the Stormtrooper helmets and modified them and made them slightly clonish here.
Slightly, yeah, between the two trilogies.
Yeah.
Yeah, and there's a great example of the Force in action, the Force grip. That was the biggest part of this game was, you know, taking the Force and just unleashing it. I mean, Wookiees flying everywhere.
Yeah.
I know Hayden had a lot of conversations about Darth Vader. Oh, and here you go. First example of Digital Molecular Matter.
DMM.
Here it is. Yeah.
Which was, I mean, this game was like a... It wasn't just that you guys were trying to do, or that we were trying to do, I'm going to say you guys, because I just kind of showed up. You guys were trying to do... No,
I think you can say we.
I'm going to say we.
All right, just your face is on the box.
All right,
so
fine,
well,
fine.
You can go ahead and say we.
We. Yeah. When I brought up the idea of using DMM, everyone was like, Sam, you're crazy.
Yeah.
You're not a dev.
No, wait a minute. All right.
Changing
you can't change the story, though.
Right. Like, you guys weren't...
What? All right. So, yeah. There was this real push to use new technologies,
yes.
too. And so... Digital Molecular Matter, and then Euphoria. Grand Theft Auto 4 actually ended up beating this game to market with Euphoria. But
we actually started it before them. Didn't we? No, we did.
Well, it was in the game, yeah, pretty early, and it became kind of a hot thing. But, this idea of, you know, these characters kind of reacting on their own and being, you know, more than just simple Havoc physics, although there's Havoc all over the game.
Someone is asking, what does DMM mean?
Digital Molecular Matter. So basically, there's... there are simulations throughout the game for all different kinds of surfaces. Like there's wood, there's glass, there's metal. Metal bends like metal. Wood splinters like wood. Instead of it just being like an art swap with just like a simple crack that you see at the same time. Like depending on...
Demonstrate with this tree.
Yeah.
So Vader... Now there's a... Depending on how long I hold this button...
Yeah.
There is a different physical consequence to the force push he's using.
Yeah.
An amount of force. So if I let it go at maximum, boom.
Yeah, so if you push it, it's different every time, and it'll break depending on what force you do. What's funny about these trees, it's hard to... I mean, the trees aren't the best example, and really, it would, you know, one of the other devs should come on and talk about this in general. I can talk to you about, you know, the sort of heart attack about trying to figure out how to do sound, but it was such an accurate... Tech invented for Indian, Staff of Kings. Yeah, that's true. It was going to be in Staff of Kings as well. Both of those games were in development at the same time, but Force Unleashed was going to be first. And we ended up, a lot of the indie team ended up working on this game to get it out the door. And but anyway, it was such a crazy accurate way of doing things with DMM that, you know, simulation, that's what I'm looking for, that they actually had to tone it down just to get it to run.
Right.
On the PS3 and the Xbox 360. And then the other thing that happened, I remember Hayden talking about this, like you could DMM a TIE fighter, you know, and like the TIE fighter ball would like, you could take it, pick it up, and then like throw it in an enemy. At one point it got stuck in a door. You know, the TIE fighter ball got stuck in a door and you couldn't progress. And it's like, well, is that a bug or a feature? Like, you know, so they had to tone it down, which is why the pieces disappear or you'd never be able to progress.
Right.
You know what I mean? So that there's like a... You know, it's like it was such a huge sim, and you know how to get it to be fun but also totally simulated was a big deal. I love that Darth Vader doesn't run; he just walks.
He walks, which is interesting. In the Battlefront beta, I saw that they kind of tried to do that. He has the same stride as he does here in the movies,
but he leaps like he does in Empire.
He leaps like he does in Empire. And in Battlefront, they necessarily gave him a nice little job. Look out, Stormtrooper! No, Stormtrooper! Out of the way! I gotta save you guys. You're my boys.
So if you pick up one of those Stormtroopers...
Yeah. Will they fire on their own man?
I don't think so, but those Stormtroopers, for Star Wars fans out there... Oh, no, they will! Yeah, and yeah,
out
and see,
of here!
The physics
You're
when,
fired!
You see, notice the physics when he fires, it actually started him spinning.
Which is a physics thing, is not animated. That's,
yeah, exactly. That's, it's all just... That's all Euphoria in action. So
Euphoria, talk about what Euphoria is.
Euphoria is basically giving them kind of a centralized nervous system to where... It's just really advanced AI, you know? And basically what they do is they... react and they try and protect themselves, and when they fall, you know, they try and catch themselves with his hands like that Wookiee did. You know, that's not animation, it's all simulated. So that's Euphoria. Of course, you know, another dev might come on here. I'm sure that if an animator came on here, they'd be like, no, Collins, you're getting it all wrong.
Yeah,
don't let the sound guy talk about animation.
Yeah, that was the thing, you were always the mouthpiece of
I guess so. I did
things.
A lot of demos, yeah.
You
but
definitely,
it's been a few years.
Do you see how that Wookiee hit the beam and started flipping over? Like, that's an example of what the simulated based gameplay. George wanted everything in this game to be proprietary and new, including even the rendering engine. Is that right?
Yeah, I mean, everything was new. The ILM was working on an engine at the time called Xeno, and this was all done. It's not Unreal or, you know, one of those engines. This was
which
a proprietary in-house engine, which, so it was not just building a game. It was building an entire pipeline in order to build a game at the same time. And so, you know, it was... You know, I always use the, I always say, like, imagine if you're mixing a movie and you're on the mix stage and Pro Tools breaks down and you have to stop what you're doing, have a meeting about why it broke down, and then you have to push out a new version of Pro Tools, then you need to test it, you know, and do all that. Well, you're not mixing the movie, you're testing Pro Tools, like,
right.
You know, or a projector, you know, let's just build and show a movie. It's like, well, let's build the movie theater, build the projector, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That's what made this game such a tremendous feat, and why I'm just so proud of the dev team. I mean,
by the way, to a certain extent, that's all video games. To a certain extent,
absolutely.
You're always inventing something new. But this game, like everything,
crazy ambitious.
Yeah, because most games,
crazy
I'm wearing
ambitious.
An Unreal shirt right now. You know, most games will use the Unreal Engine, and then they will try to do new things with the engine or next to the engine. But this was new engine, new tech, DMM, Euphoria, everything. It was just ridiculous what was trying to be accomplished here. George wanted that. George wanted, because George was coming from a mindset of ILM where they had their own tech.
And there was a lot of it was an ideal scenario for him because he had just built this, you know, like $300 million complex in San Francisco where he finally was housing ILM, LucasArts, and Lucasfilm all on the same campus in San Francisco.
For the first time.
And he's like, you know, I put you guys all here together. We should work together. And really, you know, that's the thing. George Lucas is shoot for the moon. You know, really shoot for the moon. And that's what everybody did. And it worked. Mm-hmm. You know. For example, Republic Commando was built in the Unreal Engine.
Right.
Which we had just shipped right before Battlefront 2.
Right.
Ah, cutscene. This is Tom Kane.
Tom Kane.
Whatever you want, you won't find it here.
I think I will.
You cannot disguise yourself from me, Jedi.
Turn back!
Yeah, that Wookiee's gone there.
Oh, boy. I will say some of the most entertaining bugs I've ever seen were in working on this game. Hayden Blackman really came up with an incredible story.
Now,
who is
Hayden Blackman?
He is the project lead on this, and eventually was an executive producer. He's now project lead over at 2K. Just such a badass. Everyone on the team was just some of the most talented people in the industry, and there was a huge recruiting push in order to bring people to LucasArts.
Right.
The recruiting department, they actually called it Battle of the Bulge, where they... We're like, we have this huge gap of staff we need to fill, and they were hiring like crazy. And so this team was enormous. And Hayden was really kind of the general in charge of all of it, you know.
General Blackman.
But he came up with the story of Darth Vader, you know, coming to Kashyyyk. You know, he's in the process of hunting down all the Jedi, and which we knew that he was doing. Any existing Jedi he's finding and dispatching between
Every
the trilogies.
Every single Jedi is now an enemy of the Republic.
Ooh.
Yes, exactly. So, you know, he knows there's something here, or that this person is hiding something, hiding out amongst the Wookiees.
Yeah. He doesn't know. Vader does not, and the player does not know what this guy is hiding yet, though. That's the thing. He thinks he's just hiding because he's a Jedi, but it turns out the guy is in a very different situation. Uh-oh. No, he's not. I know what you're going to say. I know. God. He just brought a TIE fighter down on my head.
Oh, you know what? I don't know if it's possible to lose this battle at the top. I think oh, maybe it is. I don't remember.
Let's hope not. Let's. I believe in. Oh God, this guy. You know, I saw someone hold. I guess his name is Kento, right? I saw someone hold Kento above here, and a TIE fighter crashed into him. You know, there was some really interesting things you can accomplish. Let me see if I can just where he can't hurt anyone.
That's awesome.
Uh-oh. No, no.
Please do not crash that TIE fighter into me.
Ow.
It is very painful, even inside this suit.
Do unto others as you would have them do to you. Here we go. Uh-oh.
No.
Ow. God. Come on. You're mine. Welcome to a quick time event.
Quick time event. I do feel like there was, there really was kind of an homage to God of War in a lot of ways in this game. I was a huge fan of God of War series and eventually ended up working at Santa Monica Studios on the God of War franchise. But these quick time events, you know, and sort of the force orbs that chase you, I feel like were, you know, at least to me as a gamer, kind of reminded me of that, and I think worked really well. So here's another cutscene. These, besides building a game, there was probably an hour of movie in this game as well.
Yeah, there was. The fun thing about this when reading the script was that we were understanding that at this point Vader recognizes this guy he's killing is kind of
now you will share his fate.
He sees that he has a child and he goes, well, that was what I was after.
This could, yeah, there's Zeb Dries right there.
Run!
There was a lot of talk about this scene, you know, that he should just stop. I remember even in the mix, I stopped his breath.
Lord Vader.
You know.
Now you mixed all these scenes.
Yep.
You did all the.
Yeah, I did all the cinematic mixes. You know, again, incredible work here by all the visuals that were done for this game, the story.
Come with me.
More will be here soon. A lot of conversation about how this would go about, you know, how this would happen. What would Vader say? What wouldn't he say? I remember Hayden stopping a meeting at one point going, I don't want to hear any more about what Vader will and will not say. Sometimes he uses contractions. Sometimes he doesn't. He says all kinds of stuff. Look, you know, like, I mean, he really had done his research about Vader. He goes, it's really, you know, it's about the performance. It's about how we handle the story. It's about making it feel like Star Wars. There's so many things that go into it. And there's our hero, Mr. Witwe.
Your training is nearly.
What was your thought the first time you saw this?
I was losing my mind. I mean, for me,
your spies have located a Jedi.
Well, to understand how I reacted when I saw this, we'd have to go back to 2007, when you called me up that one night.
Oh yeah.
My brother's what do you call it? His rehearsal dinner for his wedding. And I was there, and I get this call from you on my cell phone, and you said, "Hey, can you talk?" I'm like. Well, not really. And you're like, well, it's kind of important. Can you talk? I'm like, sure. So I went outside
I didn't know that whole side of it.
Oh, yeah.
We should pause here.
Yeah, we should.
Yeah, Obi-Wan Kenobi's in this game? What the hell? Like, this is a great little surprise here to suddenly come. What is this story? I don't understand what it is. And there's Proxy.
Ah, Master! Another excellent duel!
Proxy, you did catch me by surprise. Yeah, I haven't fought that training program in years. I thought you'd erased it.
I'd hoped that using an older training module would catch you off guard and allow me to finally kill you. I'm sorry I failed you again.
Well, I'm sure you'll keep trying. Yeah, but do me a favor. Don't ambush me anytime.
First time he's ever seen a woman?
Well, he's seen
Proxy. Maybe.
Yes. Why are we whispering?
At least one like that?
Yeah.
One like that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Your
Proxy, why are we whispering?
Finally arrived, Master. Accessing Imperial records.
Captain Juno Eclipse, born on Korolag, where she became the youngest student ever accepted into the Imperial Academy. decorated combat pilot.
I know. Sorry, everybody. We just stopped to watch because it's been a while. This looks great on PC, too.
Handpicked by Lord Vader to lead his Black 5 squadron, but later reassigned to a top secret mission.
I mean, obviously dated by today's standards, you know. I mean, motion capture, performance capture has come such a long way, but actually, at the time, yes. This was like...
But it's restricted.
Here, I'm just trying not to...
She's going to be impossible to reprogram.
Do you know why you're here?
Yes, my orders are clear. I'm to keep your ship running and fly you wherever your missions require.
Did Vader tell you that he killed our last pilot?
No. But I can only assume that he gave Lord Vader good reason to do so. I will not.
Proxy imitates.
Like a training here.
Even imitates her walk.
What have you done with my ship?
Swaying like that. He's checking her out.
I've taken the liberty.
And eventually, you can see his walk switch from hers to his. Now suddenly, he's like imitating. He's a constant mimic. There's a great little detail that the animators put in there.
You don't need to know anything about my missions except where I'm going. Now I need to jump to Nar Shaddaa. Can you handle that?
Of course.
All right.
So, yeah, 2000, was it six?
2006. It was 2006 when I called you, yeah. Yeah,
yeah, and I left my brother's rehearsal. I didn't leave, but I went outside and had a conversation with you, and you said, hey, listen, can you send me your headshot, your resume, and your reel?
Mm-hmm.
Let me just make sure the volume is suitably low. Second,
I forgot about these training levels, to be honest with you. It's been a while since I've seen this.
And I said, yeah, sure. Why do you need that? And you said, well, Darth Vader has a secret apprentice. I'm like, whoa, what?
Okay, gotta go. Bye. Yeah, totally. All right. Well, I can't tell you this, but Darth Vader has a secret apprentice, and you might be perfect for it. So go bye. Well, you had had so Amy Berth Christensen had made a concept art drawing, and it actually. I immediately thought it looked like you, but I had already tried to get you into Republic Commando and Battlefront. I've been like reading you for roles for a while because you and I have been friends for a while and huge Star Wars fans. And so, but it was really Dara O'Farrell, my boss. It was like, hey, you know, this looks like your buddy Sam. You know, it does. It does. Yeah, he goes, like, it really does. And I was like, and he was like, well, and he encouraged me to like get all your stuff. And then we snuck it into the pile because I didn't want to like suddenly hurt your chances by having it. Sometimes in those sorts of situations, it's better to just. You know, make everyone on the team feel like, okay, we went through the proper channels, we found these incredible actors, we went through their agents, as opposed to, hey, I got a buddy that could play it.
Yeah, it's not what you want. Know? When you're spending this kind of money on Star Wars, let's make sure that we don't interfere too much with the dialogue, sound-wise. I'm trying to monitor for
Master Ron Cole, okay. Respected
general in the Cully Fredrickson is Coda.
That's right. Jedi. First contact himself.
I bring Darth Vader's
first Vulcan.
First Vulcan from Star Trek First Contact.
Mm-hmm. Master Coda was a military genius, but felt that clone soldiers were unfit for battle. Instead, he relied on his own militia.
Cover.
So there were no clones in his squad when Order 66 was issued.
And after Order 66, he vanished. Official Imperial records actually claim he's dead.
Why come out of hiding and attack the Empire now?
He wants to be found.
Then we're walking into a trap. How many pilots have you lost before me?
Seven.
Oops.
Great.
Yeah.
There's a good balance of humor there. Yeah. Here's a real Coda. There was a lot of conversation about.
Lock down the command center and get that hologram projector up.
How much to make them look like holograms versus
fan out and funnel,
you know,
any
real versus you can tell it's communication, like visually, sonically.
Two, five, and 12.
You know, well, yeah, you.
General Coda.
You ended up.
I did some audio processing, and they did
there's a little dirt on the audio that you threw on, digital dirt.
And visually as well, you know, like you want Proxy to be a good, you know, simulation of these guys, but story-wise, it can, you also kind of need to be able to follow. Sometimes you don't want it to, sometimes you want to know that it's Proxy, sometimes you want to fool the audience, and so there was a lot of conversation about that.
I remember you showed a cutscene to people... over at Skywalker.
First time for Starkiller was mentioned, by the way.
Oh.
Anyway, sorry.
Yeah. So you showed one of these... You showed a cutscene to someone at Sky Sound with Vader in it.
Yes.
And the guy at Sky Sound immediately said, you know, you've almost got Vader's vocal processing right. Like, there's a little thing that you know that's wrong here. And you said, oh, that's because that's not Vader. Yeah, like that little change is because of the hologram, and you were able to tell him, like, no, what I put in is this little layer here, and like, oh, well, that's what I was here. Okay, cool.
Yeah, yeah. And if, then you show him another scene with Vader. That was Phil Benson. Yeah, you show another scene later, and it's like, oh no, that sounds like Vader, which was difficult because, you know, Matt Sloan is the voice of Darth Vader in this game, and so, you know, James Earl Jones doesn't require as much processing as Matt does, obviously, you know. So it was really trying to get Matt to have his own Vader-esque sound,
right?
You know, and you can hit all. See all these side panels here.
Oh yeah, that's
yeah.
The
you,
thing.
Can
you can yank
crack
stuff
all this
out
up.
Of here. You can.
Another great example of DMM is these doors. You can grab a piece of one of these doors, and you can just sit there and twist it and bend it, and it'll bend like metal.
Yeah.
These blast doors in front of you here.
Or you can
force push them open.
I just dented that panel right there. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's incredible. Like, originally, I think, the idea was to, yes, we killed droids. I'm so sorry. You're going to see a lot of droids die during this playthrough. Really apologize. But one of the original idea was to infuse everything with DMM in this game. Like, absolutely.
Yeah.
Sorry, buddy.
Sorry, buddy, but you
I'm
got
sorry,
to
you
go.
Go.
It was like a big physics sandbox. Like, that was the idea, is, you know, making something. And I remember the construction facility. This level was one of the earliest levels in development. One of the early milestones, you know. You can grab TIE fighters. You can grab all kinds of stuff and just have a blast, basically. You're basically made us. We built a stormtrooper torture sim, is really what this boils down to.
Yeah, basically. That was the other thing, is that, you know, it was kind of fun to put a character into a place where he fights both proto-rebels and Imperials.
Right. Yeah, his mission was to kill everyone he sees because he's supposed to be a secret, thus justifying the gameplay of, they're all going to attack you, so kill them all, right?
Exactly.
A really great example of gameplay and story kind of harmoniously coming together, and really, you know, one of the things I loved about Hayden was his ability to do that.
Yeah.
Or he still has that ability.
talk about it like he's dead.
Yeah.
Oh, Hayden, you know.
He's not in the room, so.
He really at one point had that ability.
Yeah. And so, yeah, exactly. For Star Wars Rebels fans, might be interested in knowing, all the Stormtroopers are voiced by two actors, and they had thousands of lines. And one of the actors is Lex Lang, who did a ton of Stormtroopers for us. The other is Zeb from Star Wars Rebels, Steve Bloom.
Mm-hmm. That's. So you're gonna hear you're hearing a lot of Zeb
getting
screaming
thrown
right
around,
now.
Yeah. But yeah. It was funny at Comic-Con, someone asked, so you've done a lot of Star Wars, you know, voicing and stuff.
Attention.
And I'm like right next to him going, yes, he has.
Yeah.
That's a really fun level. Yeah, that's right. You're playing on a hard difficulty.
Oh yeah, they're trying to kill me. Like, this is not. I wanted to make that guy breakdance a little bit, but like, yeah. Here, let's see if we have any questions.
Oh, yes, questions. Thank you for reminding me. Let's see. I always wanted a survival mission where you play as a stormtrooper trying to gun down Starkiller.
It wouldn't last long. It'd be a short mission.
I sniff a Battlefront mod here.
Yeah.
Oh, look at this guy. Hey, buddy. Hey, how's it going?
See you later.
This is all...
That's all... let's see. There were two actors that did this, too. Oh my gosh, and I don't remember who it is. I'm so sorry. Do I have to go to IMDb? It's really sad because I directed all these.
Yeah, let's see if we can get this guy to grab something.
Oh yeah, that's another great example of euphoria, is when they grab something and try and hang on for their dear lives here. Is he going to do
it? Poor guy. Yeah, no, I'm kind of torturing.
Sometimes he'll grab
guy.
A railing, too.
Oh, man, he's gone. There's a stormtrooper over there, though. Maybe he'll
do it. Yeah.
See if he sees it our way. Wait a second.
There he goes. There's euphoria in action.
Look at that.
So none of that is animation. That's all procedural. Yeah.
So. It's fantastic that that's. Let's see if I can get him to pry him away from that. It's fantastic that. Look at.
It's good stuff.
See you, buddy.
Yeah, such a fun game.
That was the thing. You know, it's. I think I remember talking to some kid at who worked at GameStop or something like that, and you know, I think he didn't care for this game so much. I'm like, well, how did you? Can I ask you a question? And I was like curious. I'm like, how did you play? Did you? What force powers?
Oh, I remember this.
And he said, oh, well, yeah. I just sabered my way through it. And I'm like, that's not what the game is. You know, it's you're supposed to sandbox your way through. You know, it's designed to do that.
Yeah.
I remember you telling me, And I remember not knowing how to feel about this at first. You said, you know, it is a, it's a ranged game.
It's more of a ranged game than a melee game. Yeah, yeah. I remember having that conversation, and I remember also pitching to Hayden at one point, but of course, like a sound guy, it was too late because I'm always seeing things, you know, reacting to things later because I'm further down the pipeline. But I remember pitching to him, I'm like, you know, we really should do a level where you lose your saber. You know, and like an early level where you don't have your saber and
so
you have
get
to
used to using
yeah,
force powers.
Because to me, the real secret sauce of this game was force grip and throw. Like that was to me the most, and you know, push and repulse were fun too, but especially once you level up, I mean, it's so much more fun to do that stuff than it is to just, you know, do early saber combos, especially before you have any saber combos unlocked. Yeah. Because at that point, especially, there had been so many games that had that, you know, that had that kind of saber combat.
Yeah, and the X-Men, and the lightsaber is like the most iconic weapon of Star Wars. So, you know, it's
which
kind
is
of
another reason I'm sure my suggestion wasn't really a great one, but.
Well, no, I actually think it was a fantastic one, and I think that Hayden was a fool to not listen to you. I think, you know, and history will history will prove me right. I love this. I love this, like, there's a glass ceiling here for some reason.
Yep.
Why?
Yep.
Who knows? Design.
Level up.
Oh,
how to spend. Good, I was just looking at this here. I'm looking for questions here. Feel free to ask any questions on the Twitch stream here. And Leonard sighting. Yeah, you can hear Leonard barking in the background.
Yeah, he's asking his own questions.
Yeah.
Of
why haven't you fed me?
Why
can't I play?
let's get some force stuff up. Want some force energy.
Why is it that stormtroopers always miss a target, but when I play Force Unleashed, they always seem to hit me?
Oh, you know, these are better stormtroopers.
There you go.
These are more highly trained. This is back, if you remember, this is before A New Hope. This is before the Emperor really did the budget cutbacks.
Right.
On stormtroopers.
Before they would recruit just anybody.
That's right. See, I love how it dented that wall.
Yeah, it's great. It's good stuff.
And I remember this being kind of a breathtaking moment. You blow through here.
Yeah.
And you go, oh, this place is big.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
This place is huge.
And the fact that you can grab some of these TIE fighters or you can, you know, do this kind of stuff.
Yeah, or you can trip up.
Or you can grab a TIE fighter as it come by. Or, yeah, oh, this was great. I forgot about this.
Ugh.
Yeah.
Did I just do it?
I don't know, but if you bend that thing,
someone is hurting me. Oh,
God. Oh, it's the TIEs.
Yeah, yeah, they're going for it. They're going for it. Uh-oh. I just love that a TIE pilot, an overzealous TIE pilot was making a strafing run right there and just crashes into the...
Yeah, there you go. There's some DMM in action.
Now, in the demo, if you went up, there was a way to get up there, and there was a Republic Commando helmet. Do you remember this?
Oh, I do remember that.
It's an Easter egg.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that. That was a while ago. Yeah, this is fun. Bowling for stormtroopers.
Hey, gentlemen.
See you.
Hey, gentlemen. So we should talk about the Starkiller thing.
Oh, right. Okay. So yeah. So you told me that Darth Vader had a secret apprentice, and I sent myself in. And Dara O'Farrell was kind enough to be like, "Hey, it kind of looks like your buddy." So
no.
So good. So good. I ended up coming in. And you were there.
Mm-hmm. I read across from you, I remember.
That's right. Mm-hmm. And I made the mistake of saying something to Hayden, like... Because I remember the sides for Starkiller, the script pages that you had for Starkiller, were just not very specific. Mm-hmm. You could really read it anyway, which, by the way, they were probably designed to be that way, to see what actors were going to bring to the role, rather than being super specific.
That's half true. I suppose the other half
really?
Is we probably just, it was really early in development. Because that was October of 2006 when you auditioned.
My God.
Yeah.
My God, I was
9 years ago, this
years
month.
10 years old at the time.
Yeah, you were like seven. It was weird.
Seven? Why are we casting a seven-year-old?
I don't know. It's kind of creepy.
By the time we get to making the game, he'll be just a little bit older.
Yeah. Hey,
buddy.
Oh! He just exorcist his way through, these guys with these repeaters. Yeah.
Yeah.
Heavy repeaters.
Force is destructive in this game. So I came in. I remember meeting you guys and being very nervous because it was a Star Wars thing. And I just wanted to be involved. The movies were done at this point, so I looked at the script pages and I said, hey, so how do you want this ride? Because you could do this like 15 different, or you could do it, I think I literally said you could do it 50 different ways.
Right.
And Hayden Blackman said, well, then do it 50 different ways for us. And I was like, oh.
Oh.
So you and me went through those scenes and I did like sort of Darth Maul reads, and I did kind of Han Solo reads and Luke Skywalker reads, and did all these different takes on the character.
But you were asking very Star Wars centric, I get this going in type of questions.
Right.
And
well, there was
a
meditation scene. Remember that? And and during the meditation scene,
reading as Juno. It was not a glamorous thing to be reading across. I was reading as Leia. I was reading as Juno. As Vader. That was fun.
I remember, there was a meditation scene, and I was performing it in a certain way where I was just really tense through the meditation. And Hayden stopped. He goes, why are you... He's like, let me ask you a question. Why are you so tense in this meditation scene? It's meditation.
I remember this.
Why are you tense? And I said, because the Sith don't know how to do that. He's trying something that he's maybe heard of, but he's not aware of how to do it correctly. The Sith are all about tension and aggression and getting yourself hyped up for a fight, and the Jedi are all about chill out. And so I was having moments of tension in the thing, and apparently that was a moment for Hayden where he goes, oh, interesting, this guy kind of has some ideas about Star Wars. Mm. So
that, I remember that. It was questions like that that definitely, I mean, your audition was great, but when you were kind of demonstrating that level of thought about the character, it was so obvious. Like, I remember driving from the studio back to the airport, and there was a lot of discussion in the car, and I called you and I wanted to tell you, like, dude, you've so got this. Like, I can't even tell you.
Which
of
you
other
didn't.
Auditions.
You did not
I did
tell
not.
Me that.
I couldn't. Oh, I was also sitting next to Hayden and Dara at the time. So.
You're fired.
But I just knew. I was like, oh, my God, you just nailed that. And we kept you in there for something like 45 minutes.
And most of that 45 minutes was acting. I remember being exhausted afterward.
Matt O was there, too. Matt Omanek was there.
Yeah, Matt O was. Yeah,
he's the the art lead on this game. Did an incredible job. Is now actually, I'm working for Matt on his game right
now. That's correct.
He's doing a really exciting project. But more on that when we hopefully get Matt on here.
Yeah.
To chat about this stuff himself.
No.
Yeah, the camera follows the last enemy. Always follows the last enemy killed there until another wave shows up. See ya. I should have put in the sound of bowling pins to like trigger maybe like one in every 10 times is an Easter egg.
Right, exactly. One in every 10 times would be all the time.
Yeah, exactly.
David, why did you...
Because it's funny.
I remember you playing this one time and you jumped up and you force pushed a TIE fighter and you stopped its momentum and it landed in front of you. I remember being like, and then you picked it up and hit someone with it.
Oh, really?
I was like, how did you do that? And you're like,
I'm picking up a lot of comic chatter just a few levels above you. You're nearing General Kota.
So yeah, and in terms of the name Starkiller, so this is the interesting thing. For forever, the only name that was in the script for Starkiller was Jacob.
That's right.
He was named Jacob Nion. Right?
Jacob Nion, yeah.
And it was like, well, Luke, Jacob, licensing didn't like Jacob. They eventually changed it to Galen Merrick. But what was interesting...
That was Sean Williams that named him.
Oh, right, it was the novel.
Because originally, we wanted to sort of secretly keep it as Jacob, and boom. And we didn't name him in this game. We never found out his name. And we shot something that revealed his name, but we cut it.
Well, yeah, because he said, I'm sorry, Jacob. But then eventually, we had to record a pickup of Tom saying, I'm sorry, son, for a scene much later when you go back to Kashyyyk the second time.
That's right.
But what's interesting is I remember recording a pickup script and hearing... oh, that's funny. They've done call signs for each other. This is, what is it, Rogue Shadow or Spectre or whatever it was. I can't remember. To Starkiller. And I'm like, oh, what a cute nod to Journal of the Wills, to the original Star Wars script. Oh, that's cool. His code name when he's on missions is, Starkiller. Like, that's how they say, come in. Because what are you going to say? Come in, Secret Apprentice. Like, everyone was refusing to name him, right? But then once it got out and the game came out, I think even when the demo came out, everyone in the press started referring to him as Starkiller, and that surprised us. I mean, it's funny thinking about it now, but we were like, oh, well, now everyone's just with it. When there was a vacuum in terms of there was an absence of a name, everyone just started calling him Starkiller the second they heard him referred to as Starkiller.
Well, and I don't know what we were thinking, that they'd be like,
I know.
It's the Nameless Apprentice.
It's the Nameless Apprentice, and that's
it's
fine.
It's really good. We really did it, guys.
Totally. Like, yeah. Yes. Maybe think that one through.
Yeah. Nameless apprentice. You remember George joking about what he should be called? Do you remember that?
No.
Are you?
No.
Okay. We'll leave, no, we'll no, keep go that ahead. To ourselves. Yeah, you can, oh, should okay. I? Well, you know, there was, okay, there was for a moment this, do we call him Darth something? No, he's not. No, we can't call him Darth something. And George, I think, you know, just decided to mess with the dev team. He goes, you know, he's kind of icky. And he's definitely insane. Let's call him Icky Insaney.
I was like Christopher Walken, George. That's great. He's insane.
Insane. He's crazy.
He's a crazy guy.
It's so crazy.
He's nuts. Starkiller, take out those proto-rebels.
By the way, that was your voice saying, raise the laser gates!
Oh yeah, I forgot about that.
But the thing about raising the laser gates is that it increases your chance of death by a laser gate by about 100%.
Oh yeah, let's do this to stop him. No.
No.
Goodbye! Oh god! Yeah, it's so good.
No. Tell you what, why don't you just...
No! There was a lot of conversation, too, about how groups would attack you. I remember they were trying to figure out, you know, because at first they would all attack you simultaneously, and the game was impossible.
That's a flight simulator, isn't it? This is a TIE fighter flight simulator. That's what that is.
It must be.
It's you know what this is? This is
Star it's some Tours. Sort of testing, yeah.
Because it moves. You can, you know, see what I'm saying? Like, they're like, oh, oops, I broke it.
Actually,
but you get what I'm saying? Like, you know, I've always wanted to do this. We're going in.
Be careful moving that thing. It'll start promising you cake.
Totally.
Now it looks like Portal to me.
Yeah, it's the anger core.
Yeah.
Is it this way?
Let's see if we have any questions here. Let's see, David's walking is right. Well, thank you, Jack Fletcher. David's walking is pretty strong. It's nothing compared to this guy, Christopher.
Yeah, but your George Lucas is nothing. My George Lucas is nothing compared to yours.
It's okay.
That's fine.
It does okay. Why don't you kill these rebels here and move on to the next level, please? More story, less fighting.
Let's see here. Any other questions? Any questions? Ultimately, were there any force powers? Were there any force powers from Super Keaton? Were there any force powers that you wanted to use but didn't make it into the game or didn't work out mechanically?
Wow, that's interesting. Do you know anything about that?
To be honest with you, that's a great question for Hayden. What I can say is that there were a lot of games that ended up in the second game that weren't in this one that I thought were really cool. Mind Trick was a big one, right? So in the second game, Mind Trick was actually very, very entertaining because you would mind trick a stormtrooper and you would literally watch a stormtrooper just kill itself off of a ledge, you know?
You know? There is no hope.
There's no hope. Oh, God. Yeah, it's so good. Yeah, so a lot of that stuff ended up in Force Unleashed 2. I think, you know, when it came to, you know, the boss battles, there was a lot of conversation about how to handle camera and how to handle those kind of things. And each boss kind of had their own powers a little bit. But, you know, it's one of those things where when you start off working on a game, it's like, well, let's make this huge open world thing. Well, let's make it so that, you know, everyone's got this unique stuff. And you eventually have to, you know... ship the game.
Yeah. Eventually people were like, well, let's just make a game because we're screwed.
I will say that this game was definitely like a dream come true, not only getting to get you into Star Wars, but then being able to do scenes with you as Proxy and other stuff. I mean, it was
Should we talk about that a little bit? How you got the role of Proxy?
Sure, yeah. I mean, that was...
At this point, I'm even comfortable with saying who they kind of wanted to get.
Well...
Why not, right?
Well, at one point, there were just discussions, but I don't think it ever actually went to talking to agents or anything, but they didn't know what they wanted to do with Proxy. Proxy started out as a bunch of different designs. In fact, one of them was a reverse cyborg, where it was a droid that wanted to be more human, so it was kind of Frankensteining parts onto himself.
He would take corpses off the battlefield
and try and graft it to himself, yeah.
Or skin, which is pretty grisly when you think about it.
Yeah, and you know that's Hayden. Like Hayden is such a big horror movie
film,
fan.
Frankenstein.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it was a really cool idea, and the concept art was amazing, but just seemed to be too gruesome. So eventually, this droid that was like a hollow droid that would serve as a training droid and maybe some comic relief was born. And this all came out of story meetings, and I was lucky enough to sit into some of those. Hayden let me, you know, as long as I didn't talk too much. Because, you know, there were probably like five people in that room, but we had some incredible...
I'm looking at the chat. This is the reason I'm missing these QuickTime events is you guys being awesome.
That's right.
It's not me. I'm good at games.
Yeah, that's right.
All right, sorry. I completely cut you off. You were saying something interesting.
And I love how the enemy of my enemy is my friend is going on right now, where you're working with the rebels to take it down, and then all of a sudden they just start, all right, now he's dead, and they're just going to turn on you. Yeah. But eventually we ended up casting. There were some characters we didn't have a cast when we first started shooting. We had you. We had Natalie Cox as Juno Eclipse. We had Adrian Wilkinson as Maris Brood. We had Cully as General Coda. And I believe that was like the big four. That was it. We didn't have Vader cast yet. We didn't have Jimmy Smits yet as Bail Organa. We didn't have Cat Taver as Leia yet. Oh, I think we brought in Tom Kane, and we brought in my friend Jerry Monroe, who also had a great audition. But like, there was no proxy cast yet. And they had talked about, well, do we want to do a kid? Do we want to do
so many scenes? You know, like, that's because eventually we're like, well, someone's going to have to read him when he's there. But anyway, yeah. Do you want to do a kid?
Yeah. You know, do we want to do a celebrity? You know, do we want someone like Seth Green to come in and do it? There were all these things that were brought about. Well, what ended up happening was you guys were brought in for a shoot in February of 2007. That's when we shot the main, you know, the basics of the story for to start cinematic production and really get your likenesses going so we could get them in the game.
Right.
And so during the table read, just like in the auditions, I was reading for all these other parts. I read Leia, I read Bail, I read Vader, and I read Proxy. And because you and I have been friends forever, we started joking and improvising around, and some of that improv actually made it into the game.
Sure.
You know, the whole like, shh, what is that? Who's well, that? What's that? That's girl? Pass me this note.
And what would happen was that you would be reading Proxy. People would laugh. I mean, I remember during the first table read, you read Proxy, and people were laughing. Because you were playing him so sincerely, you were playing him so sweetly, and it was certainly a color that this very dark story could have used, and also played really interestingly off the idea that Proxy was constantly trying to kill you.
Yeah, but he didn't know that was a bad thing. He had no concept that was bad. He was actually trying to please you. It's like, I promise you, I will kill you, I swear. Just give me another chance, and I will kill you. Know, it was that kind of thing, like, you know, and then really, really, like, despondent, and, like, in full-on despair when his primary programming gets wiped out because he can no longer
try to kill you. And then eventually all that's left is he can just be your best friend.
Yeah.
Which is so interesting.
The fact that he waits for the worst possible time when you're the deepest in the crap in the gameplay to turn into Darth Maul.
Right.
You know, like, this is not a good time. It's like, actually, this is the best time because you're totally distracted. You're kind of wounded. Things are really hard. And I'm going to stop everything and be like, nope.
Yeah.
The whole idea of dark side droids, which is now, of course, in the Marvel comics as well. It's kind of a fascinating idea, you know, to take something like 3PO
and
turn it into like an HK-47 from KOTOR or a proxy or like the droids from the Vader comics.
It's interesting because
like
a lot of those, you know, those dark droids came from LucasArts games.
Mm-hmm.
HK-47 being a notable example of that.
Mm-hmm.
So basically you were reading Proxy.
Mm-hmm.
You were doing a great job. And I remember Hayden was a little bit resistant, and I think it was for the same reason that, remember, you were saying, like, well, I can't just say, hey, my buddy Sam looks like...
It's not the right move. The right move is to do it due diligence and make sure that you have the best thing possible for the game. And so Dara kept doing extra rounds of auditions, but I think there was just a natural chemistry there that was just really obviously
right.
worked, and you were comfortable, and I was comfortable, and you know, my voice was in the game as temp for so long, and then finally, you know, Hayden was like, you know what, let's have you. Even when I read the stuff, you know, it took a while for it to really kind of become official. But
I remember saying to Hayden, which, you know, I'm like, okay, look, Hayden, like, let's just get this out of the way. Yes, he's my friend, so obviously I'm going to speak up for him. But think about this. I mean, we're getting the laughs, we're getting the right tone. Anyone that you would hire, celebrity or no, we would just be trying to we would just be directing the celebrity to do what David's already doing.
Right.
You know?
Well, and look, there are a lot of people in entertainment that work in other disciplines like sound that have trained as an actor, you know, or mm-hmm. or do voice acting on the side, you know, like Matt Wood or
you.
Or me. Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things. So anyway, it just kind of worked out. I was so, so thrilled to get the part. And I think it adds a little bit of sort of fun and chemistry to this. And
well, it was certainly fun for us.
Yeah. I was like, dude, my buddy Sam and I are in a Star Wars game. This is crazy.
This is kind of cool.
This is cool.
He plays my best friend.
He plays my best friend.
It works, right,
yeah.
Doesn't it?
Yeah, because we've known each other since
2001.
Let me just brag on Sam Witwer for you guys a little bit. So Sam, I met Sam because our mutual friend was
Patrick
my best
Callahan.
Friend growing up, Patrick Callahan. They went to Juilliard together. And when Patrick started at Juilliard, that was around the time that I started working at Skywalker and then LucasArts, 99, something like that. You were five.
I was 5 years old.
I was like four and a half.
Yes.
No, six and a half, maybe. I can't remember. Anyway, and Sam, you know, I got in touch with Sam through Patrick. Like, we just kind of had more of a phone conversation,
yeah.
Friendship at first.
We met in San Francisco. Because we were trying to get this independent movie off the ground.
Yeah, but even before that, I was going to tell a story that even before that, you and I were talking on the phone, and we just started talking about video games, and Sam was like, have you played this new game? It's called Medal of Honor Allied Assault on the PC. Have you played this thing? And I was like, no, I haven't. He's like, you've got to play it. And have you played Fallout 2 at the time? I was like, no, I haven't. Oh, you got to play it. And I was like, okay, cool. And suddenly he's like, give me your address. And I'm like, okay, and I give him my address. And in the mail shows up Sam's copies. I mean, we were, you know, young, we didn't have a lot of money, but Sam like just mailed me his copies, physical discs of those games for me to play on PC, just because I hadn't played it. That's the kind of guy Sam is.
I knew that years from then you would hire me for something.
I don't know if that's really.
No.
Is that why?
No,
I you're changing my whole opinion.
No,
no, but it's seriously like, I mean, this is back. You know, I mean, this is before you'd done Battlestar. This is before all that stuff. You know,
right,
I was still an assistant, I think, a sound assistant or something.
Were you? You may have been interning at Skywalker at that time. Were you?
I think it was a little after that. I think I was working on Bounty Hunter or Obi-Wan or one of those games.
Right.
Hey, Star Wars Bounty Hunter, Obi-Wan.
Dude, that's hardcore right there.
Hardcore.
Does anyone know what he's talking about?
Anyone know about Star Wars Bounty Hunter? It's actually coming out on PS4.
Bounty Hunter?
Soon. Yeah.
You're kidding
me.
Yeah.
Let's see if there's many.
Wow, I didn't see that coming. Bounty Hunter.
Yeah. Sam is bad at grabbing holocrons. Well, you know, he is talking and doing a bunch of other stuff.
That's
right.
Thank you for defending me.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Any other questions? I just beat Bounty Hunter again. Let's see. The Rebel symbol was the Rebel symbol was the Merrick family crest. I didn't know that.
Wait, you knew that?
No, it's just saying
That's
the question. Yeah, I didn't know.
Yeah. It's, of course you knew that.
Well, and this was at a time, too, you know, someone asked about you discover that the Rebel symbol is actually done in honor of Starkiller's memory after he supposedly dies in the light side ending. Oh, my God, spoilers!
Right.
but did he really die? You never really know.
I heard he got cloned.
Maybe, if you played the second game. I'm not sure. But anyway, so Leia, in honor of his sacrifice and starting the rebellion, uses that symbol as a symbol of hope and becomes a symbol of the rebellion, which is not really canon, but at the time this was a very untold story. None of that had been established.
Well, let's remind
people,
it was actually when I was before I was on the project, George suggested that, well, why don't you do the story of how the Rebel Alliance came about. Is that correct?
Yeah, I think it was something like that. Like, he had a lot of ideas, but I know a lot of it was, you know, looking back on it, I mean, George was kicking off the Lucasfilm animation with Dave Filoni and all that, and we had no clue.
No.
Like, we didn't know what was going on.
Yeah.
Because it was very, very secretive. And I think initially he was going to have it just be this sort of self-sustaining, self-sufficient thing that ran itself, which is what LucasArts very much was. You know, George would check in, but you know, he would put a lot of money and a lot of energy into making sure that LucasArts had what it needed to just kind of experiment. But he was a filmmaker. You know, he was off making the prequels and doing all this stuff, you know, at least during my time there, the 10 years I was there. But he did check in and kind of weigh in on this stuff. But eventually, the Clone Wars became a huge passion of his, and he had other ideas. And there was a deleted scene from Episode 3 about the formation of the Rebel Alliance, too, so it was wide open. The same was true with Shaak Ti.
It's one of those things that it seems that George always wanted to sort of get to, which they are now getting to in
Rebels.
Rebels.
Yeah.
But, you know, never really got to it. And at the time, again, there was, we did not know the Clone Wars was in production.
Yeah,
this was it for Star Wars, and that was what was, you know, what was shared with people at LucasArts.
I will say, you know, one thing about this, and there's been a lot of, you know, controversy with Star Wars fans over what's canon and what isn't, and, you know, the Disney bio. And I think I was just, you know, because this project was our entire lives, and, I mean, I think I gave myself ulcers at one point working on this thing because it was so, such a huge undertaking and very stressful, and it was that way for a lot of people. And so the amount of pride that we had in finishing it, you know, was huge. But that was almost to the point where it was hard to kind of have any perspective about, well, actually, if you make a game where the Force can pull a Star Destroyer out of the sky, you're yep. kind of breaking Star Wars fundamentally.
In a big way.
It makes for a great video game. Like, it really is so fun play as a video game. But, you know, as far as a story, like, the idea of a secret apprentice is really strong.
That's compelling.
You know, the ideas in here have, and a lot of the better ideas in here have been recycled into what is now considered canon through the Clone Wars. Sorry, what were you going to say?
Yeah, Clone Wars and Rebels and stuff like that. But, you know, that was one of the things when Hayden was originally pitching to George, the idea was, let's do a Star Wars game where everything is overblown and cranked up to 11, and the Force, you know, is cranked up to 11. So they were looking for, like, a superhero game, right?
And right.
That's why there was an idea of doing a Wookiee game, because, like, oh, you know, like a badass Wookiee
who's because
throwing
Hulk,
people away. Yeah.
There was a Hulk game that had come out around that time that was really, really fun. What was it called? Ultimate Destruction or Super Smash? I can't remember. There was some really, really fun smash-em-up
Hulk Hogan game.
Yeah. Incredible Hulk game that Hayden really loved, and I think that might have been why, but we'd have to ask him.
But yeah, we will actually ask him. But yeah, you know, George had to sign off on the idea of these overblown Force powers, and George said, well, that's perfect for a game.
Yeah, I'm ready.
You know, you do have to, it's kind of like in the Clone Wars, right? You see people like say, like, oh, Ahsoka Tano could beat up Luke Skywalker or something like that, right?
Right.
Because she does all these flips and he doesn't. Or, you know, or like she's so quick. It's like, yes, but she's animated. That's a different world. There's a different vocabulary when it comes to animation. I love this. He just puts his lightsaber down. He's like, oh, come on.
Yeah.
I wanted Vader.
That's the first little cinematic piece I ever mixed. This is the piece that I started with.
Really?
Yeah, setting up everything.
So you know, you have to remember the medium that you're in when you're developing these things. Mm-hmm. You know, Ahsoka Tano is an animated character, so while it's canon, the stories happen, if you were to do Ahsoka Tano live action, guess what? She wouldn't be as quick. Because a human being can't be that quick, right? So it's the same thing with video games, is that this is you know, the way that I always interfaced with it was it's a tall tale. You know, that he did something to that Star Destroyer. Maybe he didn't bring it down, but maybe he guided it or something happened with that Star Destroyer.
So
we don't know what, but the legend is that he pulled it down with the Force, you know? Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, again, in this game, if you watch, like, all of the Jedi have suitably over-the-top Force powers. Like, this thing, wouldn't a Jedi raise his shields and then do this?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Vader kind of did this in The Empire Strikes Back, but not like this.
Yeah,
this is
this is Unleashed. It's the Force Unleashed.
The Force Unleashed. That was the whole idea, is that it was going to be this completely over-the-top, overblown thing.
Get him.
Yeah! Yes! Fall. So that was, you know, that was the idea. It's like, you know, I don't think that we were ever making the statement that, like, these characters are all more powerful than all the characters you know put together. I think the idea was, this is
back to Vader.
Back to Vader. Love Cully's retelling.
Yeah, he's great. I have a great question. So, other than the titles, is this the first original cue we're hearing? Coda's theme. We heard a little bit in the opening cinematics. We had. There's in terms of music, and hopefully we can get Mark Grisky. That would be incredible.
Yeah. That'd be fun.
I'm sure Mark would do this. But the first original music theme that we hear, obviously, is the main title, which actually Jesse wrote, like, on his lunch break. It was a very last-minute thing. Like, we have all this great music. I still feel like we need some sort of main title thing to push together. And, you know, Mark was ended up getting some help from Jesse at the last minute to write it. And, you know, and then Jesse wrote a sketch, and then Mark took it and kind of made it his own and reharmonized it. But anyway, there was that. You hear a little bit of Juno's theme in that cutscene, but you hear a little bit of Proxy's theme too. Proxy has a theme which is very kind of, I think, just barely stated in that opening cinematic. It's this like, yeah, exactly. But Coda's theme, I just love the kind of bum, 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 starting out with the French horns, which always reminds me of Peter and the Wolf.
Right.
You know, this kind of very, like almost like a classic, I don't know, Victorian huntsman sort of thing.
Yeah.
You know, or the nobility of a samurai, whatever you want to say there. But and then the horns come in. I love Coda's theme. Mark just killed Coda's theme there.
Yeah.
Oh, and I love this cinematic too.
Vader thinks he's turned you, but I can sense your future. And Vader won't always be your master. I sense only me.
Yes. Ouch. By the way, that thing here, that was originally supposed to be me talking to the Rogue Shadow, and you threw in a sound effect.
Oh, like there was a...
It's better that way.
Yeah, like there was like a lot of ships and things like that. I forgot about
that. Well, because
that.
He's... The idea... Oh, God, I
forgot about that. You had a line there, like...
Yeah.
Yeah, did you kill him?
Hurry up!
Yes, sir.
I'm falling to the surface.
Was that the first lie that you told? Is he dead? Yes, I got him. I can't remember.
I think so. Because you originally lied. But it was better to not... To just... Especially with... He looks down, and before he can even see General Coda, some ship flies by, and he's like, whoa.
Yeah.
So that, you know, it makes it more plausible that he's missed. There's a lot of really subtle things you can do with sound that make these scenes work better. You want to go a little bit into the junk world and then...
we can go a little bit into Raxus. Yeah.
Okay.
Let's do it. Raxus Prime, another great example. You know, Kazdan Paradis is a Jedi who's gone mad living on a...
On a junk world.
On a junk world with spider legs.
Spider leg Jedi guy who's crazy on a junk world.
And that idea was kind of revisited
for the Clone Wars.
And I don't know if there's a direct tie there, but I imagine there is with George.
They did a good job capturing the subtlety of Starkiller lying to Vader here. You know, is he dead? Yes.
Yeah.
Because all you can do is one line. Yes.
Yeah.
To sell that Starkiller is nervous as hell right here. He's
like, yeah.
Okay, this is my first real mission. I can't really get back.
I expect you to survive. But if you destroy him,
I remember
you'll be one step closer to your destiny.
Seeing this cutscene without
the Emperor.
Oh, yeah.
And Vader
kind
of had this.
Yeah. There was a lot of conversations about animation on Vader. Vader wasn't, there was no mocap on Vader. It was all keyframe. Yeah.
So then there's this whole... This is such an interesting idea that, again, it can only be explored briefly, but this junk temple that this mad Jedi built and I just...
Skipped past it. Well, it was really good, but this mad Jedi... So this mad Jedi, built this junk planet in order to rebuild the Jedi temple, the Imperial Palace.
He built a junk...
Replica
of the Jedi Temple on this junk planet, and it's because he's so mad with grief that hey, Chuck is here, what's up, buddy? The Vader swish. He's so mad with grief that he Rex Remus is Chuck.
Yeah. Someone brought up that in the book Juno was spying on their meetings. So,
oh really?
We should probably bring up this. And someone earlier brought up the PlayStation 2 version of this game, which is actually done by Chrome Studios.
By the way, we are on the back of a Star Destroyer right now, which is so cool.
Yeah, which is very much like Episode 7 now.
Look at that. We're on the conning tower of a Star Destroyer.
Yep.
And the engines are back there. That's them. These are the engines of the Star Destroyer. So we're basically it's smashed. Directly in. And then there's a YT-1300 directly ahead.
Yeah, you can see it right there. It's the Falcon. No, it's not.
It's a YT-1300.
Yeah, it's not. You need to grab this thing. See? The camera says grab this.
Do it. Do something.
Oh, all these things were, all this stuff that you could kick around. I mean, you know, we had Eric Foreman from Skywalker Sound helping us out with a ton of these sounds. There's just so many objects you can interact with in this game. And now you've unlocked Force Lightning for this level, so that was your first Force Lightning. But,
yeah.
The visuals on this, the new outfit, someone brought up the new outfit.
You know, let's talk about, well, first of all, the new outfit is basically the old outfit, but because he doesn't have any money or survival gear. First of all, Starkiller's lightsaber is a piece of junk. It's based off of Vader's. In fact, here, wait, I've got a great replica of it that someone gave me.
Oh, okay.
That Chuck engineered for me. Hold on a second.
While you're getting that, I'll mention the Juno. There was a whole Juno subplot about how she, about what her motivation was for helping and how her whole story, because her, unfortunately, a lot of her plot got cut.
We shot it, but
we shot it, but it got cut. But it's in the PS2 version. You know, that she led the raid on Kalos, right? That was the name of the planet.
Battle of Kalos, yeah.
And she raised the planet. It's a dead world. And how she just was raised to blindly do whatever the Empire said.
She was in charge of the Black 5 Squadron. Mm-hmm. And in X-Wing, the new X-Wing game,
mm-hmm.
there is a pilot. I believe it's X-Wing or it's Armada, but I think it's X-Wing.
Mm.
There's a pilot, Juno Eclipse, that you can use for a TIE Advanced.
Oh, so interesting.
The idea being that's the Black 5 Squadron where she was flying an X-1 TIE.
Yeah, she was a total badass, but never really questioned her why she was doing what she was doing. She was raised to believe the Empire was good, and suddenly through, you know, seeing Starkiller's Black Ops missions, he's getting the replica that someone made him. This is actually really cool. Juno was really questioning her loyalty to the Empire, and this is how this crew of Coda, Proxy, Starkiller, and Juno kind of band together to make sort of the beginnings of descent towards the Empire and the rumblings of the rebellion.
So here it is. This is a replica of Starkiller's lightsaber, made by Vader's Vault, and it was always a piece of junk. It was based off of the design of Anakin Skywalker's lightsaber and Darth Vader's lightsaber, which is basically just a flash bulb from back in the day. And you could see the crystal, and it was always just, the idea was that Vader gave him just barely enough junky material to make a lightsaber. And you can see it right there. And everything that Starkiller had, especially in the beginning of this game, was junk. You know, mm-hmm. he didn't have any survival gear, so he just wrapped his face in like a blanket. And this is the uniform from the first level, except now he's just put some makeshift survival gear on there.
This is still one of the most compelling art levels. You know, it's like I think that the artist did an incredible job here. How cool this looks! You know, how burnt out it is.
Yeah, it's really, and it looks like it smells, you know, noxious and dangerous and all that stuff.
Exactly.
So, all right, let's continue in. Oh, what do we got?
Oh, just Starkiller is the secret apprentice. So, is he really going to be blabbing about him a lot? Well, yes.
Wait, who's going to be blabbing him?
I'll deal with
us, you, I guess, in particular.
Oh, yeah. Well, I should.
We're giving away all the secrets about the secret apprentice.
That's right. Yeah, destroying the mystery.
Welcome. Welcome to the end of the mystery. It's fine.
It's done.
It's done.
It's finished. No more mystery.
That's right.
It's finished.
It's gone now. Perhaps forever.
Really quick. Oh, come on, phone. This was interesting. I had an argument with Hayden Blackman about this. Check this out. I'm going to show you something.
Oh, the X-Wing?
Yeah.
That shouldn't be here.
It belongs in a museum.
Yeah, exactly.
So this. Now notice the cannons are different.
Mm-hmm.
But I remember making a big kind of.
Yeah, shouldn't that be a Z-95
that?
Headhunter, if
it
anything?
It should be a Z-95, Hayden.
Yeah.
Why is there an X-Wing here? Because the X-Wing is not developed yet. And I can't remember what he said to me. I think he said, "You're fired."
Totally. Yeah, this idea of these, what is this? Like, this is a junk lane here. This is a magnetic junk lane here, kind of like the magnetic lanes in Coruscant.
Right.
It's just bringing the junk in and processing it or something into this redone engine core. Something like that. I can't remember.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I remember this level.
And there's, you know, the question is that, like, there's a planet Raxus, I think in the Clone Wars, or it's either in the Clone Wars comics or it's in the TV show. And there's some question as to whether this is the same planet and that planet just got turned into a junk pile. Because originally, like, the idea was that the Separatist movement started on something called Raxus, although this is Raxus Prime. So, you know, you go like, was this how they rewarded the people for being traitors to the Republic? Turning their planet into a garbage dump.
Forgot about all these Rodians.
Yeah.
Oh, these are Roger Jackson voicing these.
I was just going to ask.
So, Roger Jackson is also the voice of Scream.
Hello, Sydney.
Really?
Yeah, he's a Bay Area guy who's been in a ton of Star Wars games.
Wow.
recently was Saponza in, what was that game? Star Wars Commander, I think it was. The iPhone game just came out. But yeah, he's done a ton of stuff over the years. Really nice guy.
Eclipse to Starkiller. We're picking up a lot of movement beyond that hyperdrive core.
Check the, come on.
Come on, stream. Come on, stream. Where's the streaming
That's
now?
Right. Everything will turn to
Where
stream.
Where are we? What's going on?
Let's, come on.
Oh, no, this is interesting. So we didn't have the Jawa source to cover all this stuff. These Jawas freaking out, especially when you electrify them. They're going, whatever. That's all Jesse Harlan.
Is it really?
So, yeah, Jesse Harlan, composer, has a very high-pitched tenor voice. For those anyone out there that played Thrillville and heard, you know, the songs we did, like Whiplash or Emo Skater Girl,
yeah,
he was singing those songs. He, you know, he's like built for like the big metal voice, like vocalist, really talented singer.
Well, and when you see pictures of him in high school and stuff, he had the hair to go on.
Yeah, yeah. So he, you know, great composer. But yeah, it was towards the last minute. We're like, we don't have enough sounds of this stuff. Jesse, get in the booth, you know, because he had joined the union after Thrillville. And so Jesse is doing all the voices of the Jawas, and I think we pitched it up a little, but we didn't have to pitch it up much.
Did you see that move?
That was very good.
Platforming skills, bro.
It's platforms, bro. Platforming.
Here we go. I'm just platforming. Platforms.
Platform this!
How did we survive that? Out.
Behind. Look out behind you!
Just hold him off for a few more seconds.
I love the alcoholic.
Oh, it's fine. I'm just going to Raxus Prime.
You're saying that Red Leader was an alcoholic.
Yeah, Red.
Hold him off for a few seconds. Well, I know I'm going to die, so I'm going to have a little bit more Cabrillion wine.
That's it, man. Well, he was going up against Darth Vader. Yeah. I mean, you're basically like, you may as well enjoy yourself.
Hits away! What is? There's my sobriety! Off the wagon.
Oh God! It's negative. Negative.
Negative. Go in.
Hey, are you? How are you doing? Are you? Well, are you thinking straight?
Negative.
Might it have gone in if you were sober?
Yeah. Negative. Negative. I don't believe this in myself. This is my secret power, Jedi boy. Years since I believed in myself. My wife is hanging out with some kid half her age.
Goodbye, Mr. Jawa. Oh, this is kind of cool. I love that you can just kind of, like, okay, so there's a Jawa up there. Let's see if I can do what I'm thinking about doing. No, you don't get to do this to me.
No, you don't get to do this.
Yeah, pull the garbage and boom, on top of you, my friend. I love that. I love this Republic gunship
right
here.
Yeah. There's so many little Easter eggs to kinds of Star Wars ships.
Someone told me that there was a... What was that? A Luke Landspeeder? There was some vehicle that I could never find on this board that Amy Beth Christensen said was here.
And ooh, a challenge.
Yeah.
To people that are following along.
Yeah. Can people tell us what vehicles are on this? I mean, I know there's a cloud car.
Let's see. RIP headphone users. Sorry, did we get a little loud?
Oh, God. Sorry.
Sorry about that. Welcome to the Force Unleashed playthrough.
That's right.
With Sam Witwer and David Collins.
With the most soothing sounds on the internet.
Today we're going to talk about Starkiller.
Yes, and he's Darth Vader's secret apprentice.
Secret apprentice.
It's a very peaceful game.
Very peaceful as you blow your way through ronking metal and debris.
Yeah, on this very peaceful planet of Raxus Prime. Very quiet world.
Don't fall into the peaceful acid.
No, don't do that. Don't let the peaceful sparks burn you alive.
No burning alive in Peaceville.
Look at this peaceful cloud car that crashed here.
Peacefully.
Yes. Spotted with...
Sorry.
The pilot peacefully died in there, and his corpse is still...
Well,
inside.
And I love how half of it is over there and half of it is in front of you.
Which means he did not go peacefully.
Yeah. This twin pod cloud car was separated on Raxus.
Here's a nice Corellian Corvette right here.
Yeah.
I wonder, is that in scale? I bet it's in scale.
Juno, I'm not sure.
I guess
what I'm
the idea is it should be in scale, right? Like, so the devs would say, of course, it's in scale.
Yes, it is. I remember this area being a little bit of a difficulty spike.
Oh, yes, it is. It's very hard.
Because I remember, you know, a lot of times when you're playing through a game, you're testing it, and you're just playing through it, and you're just like, I gotta get to the next level. And of course, you know, sometimes you get caught up into it. You should just use your, you know, debug to just like kill all or whatever. But you start getting wrapped up into the game. You know, you're playing it and it starts to be fun. But I remember playing this level a lot, going, man, this is hard.
Well, the best thing that I've learned for this part is just throw people into the acid, including these droids. Now, the whole thing, remember there's a line here that you and I have never enjoyed? They're like, it's almost like...
The Force.
The Force.
Yeah, I remember that.
Oh, wait, did we lock up?
We may have crashed.
Did we crash?
This might be a good time to stop.
Well, hold on. Let's get a little further.
Okay. Because
people like their Twitch streams to be a little... I'm sure.
A little longer?
It's a little longer.
I'm good for whatever.
A little longer. Oh, my.
Yes. Crashdown.
Yes.
Uh-oh. Task manager.
Yes, task manager. Close the program, but we're still broadcasting. Here, hold on. I'm going to do one of these. Fine. It's going to be smooth. Like we completely... Oh, come on, OBS.
This was planned.
Well, that's the thing. It's also...
Do we just crash?
I don't know. We'll find out.
Oh, boy.
The whole thing is that, yeah, no, we're good. We're still on.
Okay.
So what I'll do is I'll just activate the slideshow.
That's how it should be.
But the problem with some of these older games is that, they don't always get along with open broadcast software.
It's kind of you.
Yes, hold on. We're going to go for a little bit longer, ladies and gentlemen. Please stand by. As we try to get this up and running.
You really had a little bit of... you want to talk about this too? You had a little bit of Han Solo in your performance.
Yeah.
Because I remember, especially like with the way that you would yell. I mean, you yelled like a... Like you were really in pain, like a real hero. You know, look at that—the spitting lightsaber years before the Force Awakens.
Isn't that interesting? Yeah, the some of the lightsaber effects are stuff that you see later in the Force Awakens.
Yeah, so very cool.
That was the thing, is that they definitely wanted Starkiller to have be like Han Solo as a Jedi.
You can really hurt when you take damage. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, but we felt that he should also be a good deal Luke Skywalker. Remember, we came out with the formula on how to play Starkiller, that he should be,
part Luke Skywalker.
He's two parts Han Solo, one part Darth Maul, one part Indiana Jones, because there's a difference, and one part Luke Skywalker. Mm-hmm. We actually worked this out during a lunch period, and we took it very seriously. Like, I know it sounds ridiculous now, but
no, it's important. It's always for those of you, by the way, who like John Williams' music. I do a podcast called Star Wars Oxygen,
which
music
is brilliant.
John Williams, and we talk about this a lot, which is that it seems obvious in hindsight when you're listening to something that you know how it's going to go, but when you're making that stuff, you know, when George was making Star Wars and John Williams, like, they're just trying to figure it out. They don't know what Star Wars is until they made it. So in hindsight, it sounds obvious, but at the time it was like, how are you going to read these lines? You know, what's the tone that we're really going for here? Because we want it to feel like Star Wars, and it was like trying to, you know, reinvent it all over again, but also make something new. So,
well, that was
those conversations are important.
And the thing is that we were also talking about the tone of this, is that, you know, we'd spent a lot of time in the prequel universe. So this was our opportunity to step back into more of a classic trilogy vibe.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's right. This was in the middle. We had been so prequel focused at this point, you know, since 99.
Yeah.
This came out in 08. Yeah.
So it was what was it? It was basically the idea was that everything I think what it was is that we were trying to create a classic trilogy. Well, we were trying to bridge the trilogies.
Yeah,
we were trying to do create a classic trilogy vibe, but with some of the visual interest of the prequels.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, in terms of the classic trilogy vibe, that was up to people like you and me.
Mm-hmm.
And when it came to the visuals of the prequels, that was Matt Owen, all those guys. Are we still broadcasting everyone cool?
Yeah, I think so. Looks cool.
Sending these guys all to their droid deaths.
I'd love to hear Sam Witwer voice one of the survivors in Left 4 Dead 3 if it ever gets made.
Oh, God. That
You're
would be
a huge Left 4 Dead.
Huge.
You actually got me playing Left 4 Dead with you online back in the day.
Oh, God. That
Left
4
Dead 2, though.
Left 4 Dead 2.
Or was it Left 4 Dead 1? Which one was the one with Mike Patton in it?
I think both of them. I think. Oh. I think Mike Patton did.
From Faith No More.
Yeah. I think he did. Voices for both of those games. I'm not really sure, but he's done a lot of stuff. He was in Portal. He was the Anger Corps.
Yeah.
it's funny.
I think Nolan North from Uncharted did some of those too.
I think Nolan North has been in
everything. Totally.
So
was it Nolan or Troy that did this?
I think it was Nolan and Troy.
I think it was both. Very cool.
You know who we should get for this other game? Nolan or Troy? Or both of them?
Yeah, they're great. Yeah, they've both been in Star Wars. Nolan was one of the player characters in The Old Republic.
Oh, was he really?
Mm-hmm.
Who was Troy in Star Wars?
The first time I worked with Troy was in the Clone Wars Republic Heroes game that we did in 2009.
No
and
way.
He played a villain named Cull Teska. He was great.
Mm. That's cool.
But this was pre The Last of Us. This was pre any of that stuff.
Here he goes. The Force. We're like, yeah. That line read right there shows how much time we had to make this game, which was not a lot. Because if we had the time, we would have replaced that.
Yeah. But there's a lot of stuff that we did right. I remember being in the studio, and you go to rescue Bail Organa on Felucia. And there was this thing where you're like, hey, my name is, I'm here to rescue you. And you were doing it under bated breath. And I was like, you know what? And I said this to Dara, who was directing. I'm like, hey, guys, just contextually, he just killed like hundreds of Felucian warriors in order to get here. I don't think he'd be whispering.
He just blew through.
He just blew through like an entire tribe of Felucians.
And he destroyed like 50, like a whole forest full of trees.
Maybe we do an alt take where he doesn't whisper, like, I'm Luke Skywalker, I'm here to rescue. No, instead it's like,
Hey,
I'm here. Let's go. Come on.
Can we go?
There's going to be more. Yeah. I don't want to deal with them.
I really don't want to deal with them.
Yeah. So that's the take that ended up in the game.
That's right. So this is before we knew this. Well,
No. Because that was after. Very early on. That's when we were shooting. This was during, all this in-game stuff was during voiceover pickups later.
And I can tell you what happened here. I can tell you why we had the Force. Then they were doing a big battle. And again, yes, if we had time, which is not unusual, you redo lines and stuff. It does happen.
Yeah.
That's not unusual. But the me now would not have even given you the take where you wouldn't have even had the choice because that was me before it had any voiceover gigs. I had no idea. It was like the idea of doing the cutscenes was a lot easier for me because we were working with other actors and we were just like playing scenes out, right?
Mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm.
when it came to doing these isolated lines, like, okay, you're in the middle of a big junk planet that you haven't seen and there's maybe things happening or machines maybe not.
Yeah.
And it's a video game, so you need to sort of protect the context by like doing a read that can work in a variety of different noise environments, right? Like,
yeah.
Because maybe you're in the middle of a battle or maybe you're in a quiet moment or whatever. There's got to be a the example I gave is the Ghostbusters video game, which came out several years ago.
Oh, such a good game.
And some of the actors really nailed it and some of them didn't. And Bill Murray was one of the guys that did not nail it. And I think part of the reason is that his character, or who Bill Murray is, or the Venkman character, which are, I guess, one and the same, he could be quiet or he could be loud, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when Bill Murray is in a perfectly quiet sound booth, it occurs to him to be kind of quiet.
Mm-hmm.
And just there's no need to raise your voice, really, right? And I guess no one was telling him, like, no, but the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man is looming over you and cars are getting crashed and there's screaming everywhere. Now, when it came to Ray Stantz, Dan Aykroyd, I mean, his character's always like this anyway. Like, he's in a quiet environment in a coffee shop, he's like this. But then if he's out there, he's like, Venkman, we got to get that trap over there, Venkman.
Yeah.
And so, like, Stantz, Ray just sounded perfect throughout the entire game. Like, you're like, yeah, Ray is in that environment. But Bill Murray felt out of the environment.
He was reading lines that like they were all close-ups.
They were all close-ups. It's just right here.
But yeah.
And so for me, this was like this is the first experience I had with voiceover. Now the cutscenes were not voiceover; those were on-camera situations. But when it came to the in-game dialogue, this was a new experience for me.
Which, by the way, came in very late, right? Because that's done basically after design is a little bit more mature and the levels are coming online and we're, you know, maybe a couple months from shipping, you know? And so it comes in and we get people in and we're like, oh, what is this? You know, one of the things I wanted to bring up, actually, since you're talking about this, I mean, this is not a perfect game by any stretch of the imagination. I mean, there's a lot of stuff. And, you know, we talk about this a lot with being in development. That making this stuff is very difficult, and you know, one of the biggest misconceptions in game development is when things go wrong, it's because the devs are lazy. It's like, well, no, we're actually having to make really tough decisions. We've got, you know, 100 things to fix, and we've got time and budget to fix the most important 50.
Yes.
You know, and that's really what it comes down to is like, you know, we're in production, you know, and we've got a delivery date, and we need to get this out. We're not a lab. You know, and you know, even if we want to be, which most devs would just go on forever and perfect their stuff if they could, but they have to answer to the, you know, publisher and, you know, whatever. Anyway, the point is, this is the first one of these games, and I always compare this game to Assassin's Creed, you know, which came out about a year earlier than this did. The first Assassin's Creed, you know, which is now a mega franchise, very mature, has had some incredible installments in that franchise. But if you remember the first game, there were some really, really promising things about it, but it was buggy. You know, it crashed on me a few times playing on Xbox 360, but it was fun. It was open world. You could, you know, you got to be Altair running around doing all this stuff. But there's a developer that had an opportunity to really build this franchise into something that was one of the most powerful franchises in the game business.
That got to iterate.
And the Force Unleashed, you know, the most common question we're getting on here on the Twitch stream is about Force Unleashed 3. So just to put that to rest, like, you know, if Force Unleashed 3 was to be greenlit and were to come about, we would do it in a heartbeat. I know I would. I'm sure you would too. You know, there's just, if you want to see that happen, you just would have to email Disney or Lucasfilm. So, you know, even if it were happening, we wouldn't be able to talk about it. But all we can say is that, you know, it's something that we would want to do, of course, right away. But yeah, it's a shame that we didn't get a chance to do more of these, you know. And at the same time, I'm really looking forward to and very excited about the fact that DICE is putting out a Battlefront game. So,
yes,
like,
yes.
There's a lot to look forward to. And what I always say to Star Wars fans about this is, like, you know, with Star Wars, you just never know what's going to happen. I never, ever expected Disney to buy Lucasfilm. And I never expected to be, you know, to see Harrison Ford in as Han Solo ever again.
Yeah, we're getting a lot of surprises, aren't we?
And suddenly out of nowhere, it shows up again. So you just never know. Star Wars has been around for almost 40 years, and things have a way of resurfacing. I don't know, you know, what'll happen with this franchise, but, I mean, a lot of people love it, and we had a great time making it. And it's not a perfect game, but given the chance to iterate, I mean, we knew a lot about the things that we wanted to fix. And, you know, I think there's just a ton of potential here in this first installment, you know, in terms of gameplay. And
well, and the other thing that you have to remember is that the consoles were new.
Oh, that's, yeah. I mean, we didn't have a PS3 dev kit until halfway through development.
That's insane.
And when we got it, we're like, oh my God, this thing doesn't run.
Yep.
On a PS3, because you know the Xbox 360 is very much in terms of architecture like a PC, whereas a PS3, you know, its processing is multi-threaded down multiple processors, and you know it's got different segmented RAMs and all kinds of stuff like that that take a lot of fancy under the hood engineering to get to work that we hadn't even barely started on even to get something that ran it over like 10 frames a second. So like. That was very scary at first.
Was that a panic when you guys got the PS3
finally? Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. That was sometime in 2007 when we got those. And, you know, the game was going to ship in 2008. In fact, it was originally called Star Wars 07.
Star Wars 07 was the name of the
Which is why all the toys came out in 2007, in the Star Wars 2007 lines. You know, because it was originally scheduled for 07, but it slipped into 2008.
Right.
And then was held for the fall season.
There's a Trade Federation ship down there.
Yeah, control ship.
I remember the panic generally, you know, when it comes to the devs. Like, everyone was in really good spirits, really excited about the story and the game. But
there
also
were real challenges,
huge panic, because again, it's the other thing is like you kind of need to compare this game. What was that zombie game? Was it Dead Rising, where you're in a mall?
The 360 launch title?
Yeah.
I think so, yeah.
You need to compare it to games more of that ilk than the later games, you know, in the...
Certainly more than The Last of Us or...
Oh, God, yeah.
Nowadays, you know.
Yeah, like, that's... The, it, this wasn't... The games were not didn't have that level of polish, and people were not as equipped to write for these consoles. You know, this is a
this was our first time having a cast together and recording as an ensemble doing mocap. I remember
this was, in fact, in the right. I'm sorry. Go up here. I
no, please, please go ahead.
Well, I was going to say that like the mocap thing was a very, very new thing at the time. I mean, this was the first. I think. Look, if it's not the first time that people used, I'm sure we couldn't have been the first time people used likenesses along with the actors, but it was, I think it was the first, might have been?
Might
was
have been.
It?
I mean, I know
it was certainly the first widely publicized.
Yeah, I mean, like Naughty Dog, for example, was doing Uncharted, you know, all mocap. There were people that were doing mocap. I mean, Grand Theft Auto games were mocap, but,
right,
you know,
but
it was different
than
the voice actors.
Were they hired actors to...
Who did the voice, did the mocap, and it was your likeness? I feel like, someone correct us if we're wrong, but I feel like this was the first time, you were the first walking, talking look-alike of a video game character.
I believe that may be true. Maybe the audience can tell us if we're right on that or not. But, but to my memory, like that was a new thing. Like, you know, when you said, "Hey, we're doing this Star Wars game," I'm thinking, well, at first I was thinking, "Oh, cool! I would love to do a voice in a Star Wars game." Oh, this was a Jedi Starfighter, and I just destroyed it. Oh, that was, look at that!
Wow, an episode 3 one. That's cool.
That's kind of cool.
There is a question here, by the way.
Oh, what's the question?
Do you guys give input when using your character in another game, or do you just let them do what they want with it, like Starkiller and Soul Calibur? So, those guys did. You did all the voice for Soul Calibur.
That's right. Yeah.
They did come to LucasArts and talk to us, and I gave them a bunch of sounds I was developing for the game. And, no, they definitely consulted us. But, you know, it's a different style.
It's the same thing as... Right, yeah. You have to apply Starkiller to it, or these characters or the situations to a different... medium.
Yeah,
really.
Traditional, more Japanese fighting game like Soul Calibur. Yeah.
But, you know, this thing about... using actors and their likenesses. I mean, this was, again, it's something that is now being done a lot. In fact, I'm not breaking any NDAs by saying I'm doing it right now for a different thing, not a Star Wars thing, but, you know, where it's our likeness and it's our mocap and we're on the stage and we're doing it. And the tech has come. The tech is totally different. Back in the day, we were over at ILM, we were with Mike Sanders.
Brilliant guy.
This is the guy that, you know, has like Academy Awards for like Pirates of the Caribbean, Davy Jones, and all that stuff. And he would come up with this stuff in terms of how to do it. I remember being in the ILM. He had this sort of domain, like the research basement.
Yeah.
At ILM, and you'd go down there, and I remember seeing, and I don't know if it had been used on a project yet or if they'd already built production models of what this was. But I remember seeing the prototype of a head-mounted camera.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like...
Which is standard now.
Yeah, standard now. But yeah. Like, it was like a helmet, and there were like wooden sticks. And they were like...
Wasn't there like a coat can or something?
Yeah. It looked like it was made out of a coat hanger, a couple wooden sticks.
It was
like
from Explorers or something like that.
It was so primitive.
Phoenix make this? Are we going to space?
Yeah, it was very interesting. And I remember being like, is that... That's like a camera you wear on your face?
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah. I'm like... And I remember thinking, that's got to be really cumbersome. Yeah. You know, like, how do you do that? And, you know, fast forward, now I'm doing that, and everyone's doing that.
And ILM, just a shout out to ILM. They're just one of the most brilliant groups of people on the planet. I mean, they're just, what they've done, they've just changed entertainment forever and ever and ever, and they're still doing it. Like, now, they have this ILM X-Lab thing.
Oh, right. Yeah, what is that about?
I don't know, because I haven't been there in 5 years, but... you know, they put together this incredible virtual reality group.
Which and Sanders was involved
in
that.
In the early steps.
That's right. I remember going down to that same research basement years later. This was maybe, I want to say 3 years ago. I wandered down there and he was there. And I'm like, what are you doing? What's going on? And he's like, oh, check this out. So he gave me like a block of wood and which was a virtual camera. Basically, the computer knew that this wood was meant to be the camera. And he...
Oh!
First death.
Nice job.
First death.
Hey, you know what? You got this far on Sith Lord.
That's, yeah.
And you're talking.
And I'm talking.
Yeah.
But he brought me down there, and with this virtual camera, there was, I was in a warehouse. Like, he had it hooked up to a screen, and I would move this block of wood around, and I would see that I was in this warehouse. And I'd turn the camera around to, like, his assistant, and when I point the camera at his assistant, it was Indiana Jones. His assistant.
Oh, wow.
Like, they had an Indiana Jones 3D model, probably from the Staff of Kings, and they plugged it in, and they told the camera that that was Indiana Jones, and it was just kind of an impressive little demonstration there. So, you know, they've been doing some really interesting stuff, and Force Unleashed was, I remember that they had, like, VR demos with Force Unleashed characters for a long time. In fact, our faces were hanging in their research basement for years afterward.
Yeah.
This is all part of, you know, like, the thing with ILM since the beginning, since you know, all the way back to, you know...
76?
76, is that all of the R&D that they did, or any time that they did a movie for someone else, they were financing their own research and development by taking these jobs. They were, you know, they would be like working on Close Encounters, or was it? Yeah, they did Close Encounters, and they would be effectively.
I don't think they did Close Encounters. No, they didn't do Close Encounters. their first non Lucasfilm movie was Dragon Slayer.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Mm-hmm. Other than that, all they were built specifically for Star Wars.
So. Or the Star Trek movies or whatever.
Star Trek was it, yeah.
Yeah, and so these would be, you know, they'd have Paramount come in and they'd do special effects for, you know, Paramount. But that was just so that they could get better at it. They were putting money into the machine of making special effects. And, you know, we all kind of benefited from that. And that was Force Unleashed was definitely... a little bit of extra R&D money in their pocket.
Yeah, it was great. There was a real synergy there, which is exactly what George was hoping to get out of this, which is why that we weren't just going with off-the-shelf, you know, game software. It's like, well, no, you have an opportunity to really do something great. Do something great. ILM is just incredible.
Yeah. I've turned off
this junk off.
What do you call it? You have the... The status bars for the health of the enemies. Maybe I should turn that back on.
Oh, just to see.
Yeah, I was hoping for a more cinematic experience. But
we did get a question though. Do we have a favorite level? Do you have a favorite level in the game?
Oh man.
Do you have one?
Empirical's pretty fun. I like.
Empirical is fun.
Kashyyyk 2 is pretty bleak and interesting. The Death Star was certainly fun. It's really hard to say.
I would say for me it's probably the first Felucia level.
Yeah.
Just because it's so gorgeous.
Yeah.
And
it's
incredible. Are you fighting Rancors in the first one or is that the second one?
Second.
I feel like you do a little.
Oh,
in the first
you know
one.
You do. You bump into one.
And I love the contrast of seeing it at first and then seeing it when the Empire has completely ruined it later.
Well, that was Hayden Blackman's and everyone's genius in making this game is that, like, they realized, okay, look, with the level of visual fidelity that we're going to be going for and how good we want everything to look, it's going to take a lot of time, money, and effort to get it to look like that. So if we're going to create an environment, we kind of want to reuse it, or at least reuse assets from the environment. So he created a story where, in the beginning, when you're working for the Empire, you visit these places, and you're part of
the
force that's destroying it,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And then when you come back later in the game and you've kind of made the turn toward the good side, you are now in those same areas looking at what the Empire has done, because, you know, partially because of what you were involved in. You're seeing the destruction and how it all played out later, and then you're trying to put it back right, you know, which is really an interesting, like, to reuse environments and assets is one thing. To make it into a good story point is...
Well, and this is a funny point. I was just to piggyback on what you're saying there. I think initially the idea of going to Kashyyyk twice and Felucia twice and Raxus twice was reuse of assets in order to try and be smart about building something under a limited time frame.
That's right.
That's not what ended up happening at all.
Oh, really?
I mean, what ended up... I mean, the Felucia 2 looks so different from Felucia 1.
That's true.
Maybe they had some of the same digital assets, but they were given a completely different paint job. You know, there were so many different areas, you know, all different characters, all different combat. Like, I mean, really, this is a question we should say for Matt O, because he might say, no, we were able to do that stuff. But from my perspective, I just remember looking at this going, these levels look nothing like each other.
Yeah.
Maybe Raxus a little, but like, Kashyyyk 1 looks nothing like Kashyyyk 2.
But that's a lot of that is lighting, isn't it?
Yeah, but I mean, you know, you're in... Yeah, I guess
it's all lighting.
I guess a little... But yeah, like, that's not... Yeah, we'll talk to ABC
about
that.
Yeah, I know. We have no idea.
That wasn't hard for you, was it?
No,
yeah, just turn the lights down.
The computer just did it, right?
The computer just did it.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
We're so terrible.
Totally.
That's definitely, yeah, we're always very ignorant as to whatever. Do you know, actually...
No!
Why don't you talk about the challenges of sound when it comes to DMM and all this stuff? Because you have, like...
Yeah.
I mean, dude, you must have... When they were demonstrating these technologies, because I remember seeing online, there was some games developer conference, and they did... LucasArts did a demo of DMM, which mm-hmm. had Indiana Jones on a rope bridge, and they were throwing things at him, and he was responding. He was, like, trying to keep his balance. He was trying to do these things, and they kept saying, this is not pre-animated. This is not pre-rendered. That is a digital Indiana Jones that
at runtime,
who's trying to regain his balance.
It's not animation. Look, you can do anything. You can shoot something over here. You can twist the bridge like this, and he's going to try and hold his balance. Really early rough demo. So, you know, it's funny because when we first looked at it, it was actually much scarier than it actually ended up being because, you know, we realized with DMM, you could, like I said earlier, you could do anything. You could do anything with this technology, you know. I mean, you could basically splinter any... What's that?
Republic Walker.
Oh, yeah.
See that?
Now, did we decide, is that an ATTP or an AT or LAAT? It's one of those.
I don't remember. Someone in the room could probably
tell
us.
Yeah, somebody tell us what...
But that's the same Walker that they use in Rebels, isn't it?
I think so, yeah.
It's a modified version of
that. They turned into their RV.
That they turned into their RV, yeah.
But it wasn't so procedural. Like at one point we were like, well, do we want to digitally model sounds? What kind of processing is that going to take up? Ultimately, what we realized is that more so than Indiana Jones, The Force Unleashed is a fantasy game. And really the DMM that you're breaking is stuff that, you know, you don't run into in real life. So you can just get away with big bombast and metal, huge metal ronks and impacts and stuff like that. So we ended up having a matrix of velocity. I don't want to get too boring here, but basically, depending on how hard you hit it, it would randomize one bank of sounds versus another bank of sounds. If you were grabbing something and you were bending it with the force, like some metal, you had sort of a warping metal loop playing that would go up and down in volume and play little ronk one shots, is depending on how hard you were pushing your thumbstick to bend it, how fast you wanted to bend it, or how thick or thin the metal was, how fast it would bend. And if it bent too fast, we wouldn't do that at all. We would just do a one shot of a rank, you know, like,
right.
So every object we had to kind of treat, there was a guy named Damien Kastbauer who was responsible for basically dealing with this giant matrix of velocities that coincided with sound banks. And I did a whole GDC Austin talk with Damien on this in 2009, but at the time was really scary, but ended up being a little more manageable. And Eric Forman did all those sounds from Skywalker.
Because traditionally with video games at the time, it was just, hey, if a gun fires, you trigger this sound. If something hits this, it trigger that sound. And, you know, and this was like, we don't know. We need, you know, like, we don't know what this is going to be. We don't know what the player is going to do, and we don't know how the materials are going to interact. So what does that sound like? We have the materials. The materials are being digitally modeled. So how do you create sounds that were going to be adaptive mm-hmm. to that? Mm-hmm. You know, like this.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, how do you know exactly what the player is going to, how he's going to manipulate that mm-hmm. piece of metal.
Yeah, so it's all series of one shots and loops, and when you let go of the button, it'll play like an end shot to end the loop, that kind of stuff. So.
Or when you die.
And when you die, we just mute everything.
Mute everything. Yeah, you just as here. I think we go to Kasdan Paratus and.
Kasdan Paratus.
And then maybe we'll take a few more questions and then call it.
Yeah.
But again, you know, again, Kasdan Paratus is a very interesting little thing that we are on a junk world trying to find a Jedi who has spider legs. And that story is near and dear to my heart as as we, you know,
yes.
in the Clone Wars.
The proto Darth Maul.
Proto Darth Maul, exactly. It's just interesting that these ideas, I wonder if Hayden Blackman feels kind of like, yeah, these are good ideas, considering the fact that so many of them have appeared in different places.
Yeah.
We have another good questions.
I was just looking for one. This is a good question. What's the story behind deciding to use the reverse lightsaber form? Sheen lightsaber form?
I think that's what it's called.
Yeah. That's a great question. We had done that in a game called Jedi Starfighter. one of the characters had used it.
Who had it?
It was oh, what's her name from the Jedi Council? I can't believe I'm blanking.
Stas Ali or
no? Oh, I forget her name. I forget her name, but she had a reverse fighting form, and I think in Jedi power battles as well. And I think that that's really a great, that's a Hayden question or a Matt O question, but I think it was more just because it looked cool. And I think actually Manny would be the guy to answer that question.
Manny would know, you know, but that, I think part of it was we knew that it was going to be a third person title.
And you can see the lightsaber running behind you. Oh, that's let's exactly go with right. that. Let's, we'll go with that. That I actually like,
you like
that,
that
answer. Yeah. Yeah. That's
like
good.
That?
But it's actually probably true. But what was great then when the Clone Wars started and you saw Ahsoka carried it that way.
That's right. And the idea that Ahsoka and Starkiller both got trained by the same guy.
Oh.
And so Anakin's like, you know, I don't do it like this.
Geeking out right now.
I don't do it like this, but I think you should try holding it backwards. I think you'd really
try holding the lightsaber behind you. I can't do it because I have a cape.
You have to understand, my cape would get cut up.
So I hold it this way. I never did it before I was this cyborg, but I think you should. I always wanted to. Obi-Wan never let me hold it this way.
He's holding me back.
He's holding me back. Obi-Wan didn't let me do this.
He was jealous.
He was jealous of my ability to hold Sheen style. Billy Sheehan style.
But I'm going to train my apprentice to do it. I love that my Anakin is also an alcoholic. But all these Star Wars...
Hayden Christensen. So sorry. We are portraying you like an alcoholic.
No, it's more fun for us to portray all Star Wars characters like alcoholics.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of other ones.
Well, that was the thing. You know, it's like that Red Leader. Remember his original dialogue in Star Wars Episode 4 was... I knew your father when I was a small boy.
I was a small boy.
He gave me my first sip of beer.
That's right. He used to go into the Anchorhead liquor store and buy me booze. He was a good man.
If you're anything like him, you'll do all right.
If you ever see that Darth Vader, tell him he owes me a drink for killing your father.
That's funny. How are we doing on questions?
I don't know. Sorry. Got distracted there.
I'm useless when it comes to questions because of driving here.
Can you do an alcoholic Admiral Akbar?
The trap!
I don't know.
You can see Tresto orbiting the forest.
Sorry.
Make sure that doesn't happen.
I'll hold this.
We could have a catastrophic meltdown on the
I almost
computer.
Dropped the iPad on the keyboard.
The keyboard.
Yeah.
You can see over in the front.
It's a Pabst. No ribbon.
That's it.
No,
that's totally it. That's no, I like it. I'm all for
you're
it.
You're going for that.
I'm gonna back you up on that. Yeah.
It's a Schnapps.
It's a Schnapps.
I always said about Admiral Akbar that he was such a detriment to Rebel morale that day.
I know.
You know that there's. It's like
you're screwed.
You're looking for the. You know, you're looking at your leaders too. It's like when you're in turbulence in the air. Whenever you're in turbulence, you look at the flight attendant.
Everything is fine. Don't worry. We're just hitting a kind of bumpy ground here.
Well, like, I think I was on an airplane that got struck by lightning. And you look at the flight attendants, and they're just like, yeah, whatever. And you're like, oh, I guess it's normal. And, you know, so you're always looking for the people that are sort of in authority as to how to react in any given situation. So when Admiral Akbar is like, you know,
it's a trap!
You see the rebels are like, what?
Yeah.
Oh, God. Okay. This is... Oh, God.
Oh my god.
And then of course, you know, Lando's like, hey, bring him closer, as close as you can.
Also
our
drunk.
Cruisers can't repel firepower of that magnitude.
Sand better than it would against that Death Star.
I just hope that, like, people weren't overhearing that conversation. They're like, so we're on a suicide run now?
So we're gonna die, is what you're telling us.
There's no hope. Like, basically, I'm hearing what these guys are saying, and they're saying, this is not happening. We're going down. This is not good.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm trying to get my Force Lightning maxed out because Kazdan Paradis does not like Force Lightning.
No.
He doesn't like
it. It's a trap!
Okay. Well, I guess we're just going to have to go in. No problem.
Go in. You got this.
And then after we defeat Kazdan Paradis,
we'll call it for today. We did pretty well. That's like three levels.
Exactly.
Two boss battles.
Yeah. Well, we have... I'm expertly guiding us through.
You timed it out.
For those of you who are giving me nonsense about not getting all the holocrons, it's because
I'll defend you from this Sith trash.
Do you see?
I do.
And I'm not dying.
Mostly. That's right. That's right.
I'm not doing it.
I remember this being a pretty hard boss
battle. Oh, God, yeah. Dude, this guy was a...
You know who voiced Kasdan was the guy from... Was it Darkman?
Dude, Darkman, yeah.
Darkman, yeah, the original actor from Darkman.
The bad guy.
Oh, he was the bad guy. Right, because Liam Neeson.
Yeah, it was Liam Neeson.
Yeah.
Liam Neeson did
I'm here to tell you that you are not going to leave this drunk temple alive.
You're going to leave our home alone.
I would like to do some improvisational comedy now.
Now. No, we're going to do it now.
I love how if you hurt the Jedi in the chairs, he freaks out.
Like, yeah. Oh, please, yeah. Not Mace Windu.
Yeah.
Snakes on a plane.
No.
There. Don't yeah, I just hurt his feelings. Okay, so I guess I should start fighting him, actually, shouldn't I?
Yes.
Instead of making jokes.
We're going to fight Kasdan Prox.
I gotta be honest, I forgot about so much of this. It's so good to see it again. I haven't played this game in years.
God, I just remember what fun it was to be in San Francisco working on this.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was just like, it was really, really an incredible experience. And I'm getting my butt kicked right here. I'm having a hard time being wistful while I'm being violated.
There's a lot of great comments too about the story. People really like the story. I gotta say, I'm really proud of the story of this and what Hayden came up with. And Hayden actually won a Writers Guild Award.
And who?
For this.
Bryan Cranston gave it to him.
Oh, interesting.
Heisenberg was the one that was delivering that particular award. Oh, my DMM.
Oh, like, no. Yeah. Oh, I'm just gonna fall down.
I can't do it. No, I'm just drunk.
Yeah. Yeah, DMM sometimes had some unintentionally comedic responses there. But yeah, what were we talking about? Oh, the story. Yeah, I mean, it really is a cool story. And one of the great moments we had as developers was, you know, ILM's got a huge movie theater, really nice movie theater called the Premiere Theater. And as the game was done for a big company meeting, we treated everyone to a screening of just all the cinematics on the big screen.
Was I there?
You were there. I invited you for that. We watched them all on the big screen. It was probably about an hour long.
This is at the LDAC.
At LDAC, mm-hmm, yeah, the Premier Theater. So it was really great because it was fun hearing, you know, something that I mixed in my little sound pod in this giant movie theater, knowing that wish that everyone could hear and see it that way, even, you know, with last-gen console fidelity.
I remember the big press thing where we had all the people from Europe and all over the world coming in and seeing what we were doing. They had us all over at Skywalker Ranch, and that was the first time that I'd stayed at the ranch. And I remember we had a little you, me, and Adrian Wilkinson and a whole bunch of the devs. We got together in my room and watched King of Kong. You remember that?
Oh, the documentary.
Yeah.
Well, and that was neat too because I remember Rick McCallum was there.
Right.
And a bunch of, I think Kevin Smith and a bunch of other people were there.
Right. And I bumped into Ron Moore.
And you bumped into Ron Moore from Battlestar. It was like, you know, that's the thing about Skywalker Ranch. You would just run into people, like, you'd see insanely cool people there all the time.
Yeah, I remember we were hanging out in one of the hangout rooms in the main house. And,
right.
And there was, you know, I was looking around and I saw a bearded man who looked a little bit like Jesus. And it was Ron Moore. And he was sitting there with a bunch of guys, and I'm just like, what are you doing here?
I forgot about this.
Yeah. He's like, what are you doing here? I'm like, I'm working on Star Wars. I'm like, what are you doing here? He's like, I'm working on Star Wars. And that's like all we could say to each other. Because he was part of the writer's room on the Star Wars live action show, which...
That was in pre-pro at the time.
That was in pre-production. You know, it's... Oh, no! No, this is not... No!
You can do it!
No, I can't.
Yes, you can.
I cannot. So, and from what I understand, those scripts that they wrote are extraordinarily good. I hope that Disney puts those scripts into production. And I also hope that they, like, hire me. So
you should be in a Star Wars TV show or a movie. Can let's just start. Let someone start a change.org petition for Sam Witwer.
Change.org. This has to change.
Yeah.
We can't stand for this.
Yes, exactly. No, but seriously, you'd be amazing in one of those.
Oh, thank you. That's very kind. I just want to read those scripts. Apparently, George commissioned something like, was it 50 scripts or something?
I don't know. Whatever was in the press release. I don't know.
Whatever was in that press release. But it's something we'd all like to see, and hopefully one day we will. I understand it's... I don't know that... It's not that Disney is being mean to us by not showing us.
We have so much Star Wars going on right now.
Yeah, they're a little bit busy right now.
Five movies in 5 years, plus a TV show, plus games, plus comics, novels. I mean, there's so much Star Wars happening right now. It is a true renaissance. I feel like this is like the episode 3 of cultural Star Wars spiking going on, right? Yeah, episode 1 being the original trilogy, episode 2 being 99 from 05, and now episode 3, the return of Star Wars under the mouse.
And that's the thing, you know, for the first time, we're looking at a Star Wars that is this is like a unified Star Wars, because, okay, so for the original trilogy, that's for all the older fans, right? The older fans are like, there's only 3 Star Wars movies. If you go even older than that, I've talked to people who are like...
Just
only,
like the original.
Who are
maybe Empire.
There's only one Star Wars movie, and that's the original Star Wars. And The Empire Strikes Back didn't really do it. There was a weird Muppet in that. I've actually had conversations with people that are like...
Well, and Charles Lippincott, right?
He was like,
no, that's not what Star Wars is. Star Wars is Kurosawa. You don't put Miss Piggy in your Star Wars or something like that.
Right, and during that interview, they were like, are you aware that Miss Piggy character is like one of the most beloved characters in cinematic history? And he goes, really? He just didn't know. It's just something that was not on his radar.
Right.
And, so basically, you know, you have your older fans, like I guess that would be us, who grew up with the original trilogy, who were like, it's the original trilogy. And then you have the younger fans who are all about the prequel trilogy and the Clone Wars and all that stuff. And this Star Wars movie benefits from everything that came before. You know, when Harrison Ford goes, you know, the Jedi, the Sith, they're real. You know, it's all true. All that stuff. He's talking about 6 movies worth of history and a TV show and all this stuff. And so for the first time, we're in a period of Star Wars where it's like everyone is kind of poised to accept what's about to happen. On the other hand, we also might be coming into a series of Star Wars where like we have a third generation. Like our generation goes, no, there's only 3 movies. And then the next generation is like, no, there's only the prequels.
Oh,
and then someone else can be like,
stop it.
Only
stop
7,
it.
8, and 9.
Well, give me that Batman, you know, and Robin... meme of him smacking. There's only 3 movies. They're all movies. Smack Batman.
Right.
Smack Robin. No. And then you know, people are too quick to bag on Star Wars that isn't their Star Wars. If you just let go of the hate, there's so much to love. You know, some things pop you out of the movie. Fine, but that doesn't mean they're bad.
That popped me out.
Sam.
Where's it?
Sam. What have you done, Sammy?
Sammy,
Sammy.
Open up it's your brother.
Open up it's your brother.
Sam, little Lost
You're
Boys
a vampire,
reference.
A blood-sucking vampire. I'll wait till Mom finds out about
I'm
this.
I'm your brother, Sammy.
Sammy, don't die against Kaz and Paratus.
The iPad?
Oh, the iPad. He's here.
Hold on.
Scroll down.
Scroll.
No, it's all the way down. Oh, scroll up, maybe.
Oh, it's scroll down, scroll up, scroll everywhere. You have one job, Collins, and that's... to look after the iPad and say a bunch of interesting things and remember a lot of things and talk intelligently about the years you spent on this project. One job. Damn it.
I have failed you.
You have failed. Dude, this guy is tough, man. Like, he's... And I did not level up the way that I thought I would level up. I'm failing everyone, man. I don't even remember how to defeat this guy. I don't remember what I did. So I'm just kind of going. How are we doing? Any?
I'm still looking. Question for David: can we hear some proxy? Oh, that's nice.
Dude, do some proxy. Can you comment? Can you be the proxy commentator on this?
Sure. Part? Yeah. Master, be careful of Kazdan Paratus. I don't really know what else to say other than he's a crazy spider-legged mf'er. I got nothing.
Spider-legged...
Use your Force Lightning, Master.
Yes, it's what it's for.
I'm trying, Proxy. I'm trying.
Do you remember Force Unleashed 2? Actually, there's a section where you're jumping from... And we pitched this thing that Julio Torres didn't go for, probably very wisely.
We
Master... Pitched. Do you remember this?
Yeah.
Master, jump.
Jump.
Jump. And then at one point I go, jump! And you're like, what did you say? I'm like, Master, jump! And you were like, Proxy, I'm trying... What did you say?
I'm trying to concentrate here, Proxy.
Yes, yes, Master. I'm sorry.
That's right.
And you were like, damn it, proxy's down. I'm sorry, I'm just trying to fulfill my primary programming. I'm sorry I failed you again. That whole thing.
Oh my god, I totally...
Master, jump. And then at one point I go, jump! And dang it! You know, just trying to... like, and I wanted them to trigger it like right as they knew the player was about to hit the jump button. It's just to trigger proxy going, jump! Like, just to get people to die. Julio was not having it. That was in the... when you were chasing that giant...
spider creature
in Force Unleashed 2.
Force Unleashed 2 in the ship.
Master.
But I love that you totally remember the punchline, which is, I'm like, Proxy, I gotta concentrate. And you're like, oh, sorry.
I'm sorry. Jump.
He's just whispering it. Oh, you know, it's funny. I was just gonna say, like, because you and I pitched a lot of funny things.
Yeah, we did.
And we generally got shot down, but that one, I don't know. I think that would have worked. Because Proxy could be funny.
Master. Jump! You would be great to do like a commentary of just, Master, don't use your Force Lightning. He loves it. Just like say everything that's wrong.
Yeah.
Master, run towards him with your lightsaber deignited. That is the only way to defeat Kazdan Pratis.
Yeah, because Proxy.
My databanks show that it is impossible for you to win. You might as well give up now.
Jump.
Kazdan, this is Proxy. Would you like me to come and join you?
Oh, God.
I can turn into any one of your Jedi Council members. You want me to be Silas Carson. No, what's his name?
Silas Carson.
What's that?
Ki-Adi Mundi.
Ki-Adi Mundi.
Yeah. Silas Carson.
Silas Carson.
No, oops. Not the pilot. Not the pilot who dies in the beginning. Ki-Adi Mundi.
Ki-Adi Mundi.
He was, right? He was that pilot.
I can be
Captain
Plo Koon.
Look.
Master Kazdan Paratus.
Oh, dude, that's, yeah.
James Arnold Taylor.
James Arnold Taylor as Dave Filoni's favorite character.
Plo Koon.
Plo Koon.
Did you get him?
No. No. Yeah, wait. No. Guys, there was a time where I could do this a lot better. I'm just playing it safe here.
Oh, Master, this is taking forever. Just give up. Why not give up?
Go to sleep.
Go to sleep. I see a comfy spot right over next to that pile of garbage over there. It doesn't matter which pile, really.
Okay. I'm just trying. That's what I'm trying.
Question, Master. Do you have a power called Force Stop Your Heart Beating? If you just use that, it would be so much easier.
You know what's hilarious?
Hold your breath for a while.
It actually works. Like, I'm actually playing worse.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No. This is. But we're doing a commentary, so this is your job. You're doing your job, man. You're doing your job. You entertain them while I die a lot.
I wonder how painful those spider legs actually are if they impale you.
Guys, look at this. This is terrible. Come on, give me to the second junk golem. I want health, please. No, please. No. Damien, no. Why you do this to me, Damien? He's sometimes immune to lightning. I don't know why that is. Uh-oh. What is going on? Oh, here. I think it's on. Oh, God. How are we doing on
question.
Chat.
Sorry, I
got so involved. Can you do some Palpatine for us? Say something funny or out of character or something!
Can you do anything but die? I can. Give me a second.
Okay.
If I start doing Palpatine now with this level of health, you're just gonna hear me die. That's all. No! No! Oh, this is bad. You'll notice I'm going for the sure thing here, rather than actually engaging in an interesting way.
That John Cusack movie?
Yeah, the sure thing. That's what I'm doing. That's what I'm going for.
I could hear that in your performance a little bit. John Cusack.
It was two parts.
Not Joan Cusack. Oh!
Right at the QuickTime event.
Sorry.
A beautiful temple. No!
Oh, back here. Good. You better start answering some questions.
Oh, yes. All right, so more questions. Will you still owe us a Palpatine voice?
Excellent. Your feeble skills are no match for the power of the dark side.
Let's see. So there are many people...
David, what did you think when I said to you... I'm going to ask you something for the first time. Be honest, when I was like, hey, I want to play Palpatine, were you like, that is the stupidest thing I've ever heard?
No. I just didn't, you know...
Because for Force Unleashed, this is the first time that I did Palpatine, this game. And I remember going to David and being like, I want to do it, bro.
I just remember thinking, well, first of all, I was secretly impressed with the level of ambition on display. I'm like, you know, you're starring in this.
Power mad.
You do know that that's your face right there. Yes, but I want to be all the characters.
I want to be everyone, David. Don't you understand? I want to be you.
It really was is you did a great Palpatine. In fact, you read the lines for us, and it was really good. I just remember being a little nervous about, you know, challenging Dara about it. Because it wasn't about convincing me. It was about convincing Dara. He was really directing that stuff.
And Hayden as well.
And Hayden, yeah. And so it eventually worked because you auditioned for it and it was awesome. But I remember thinking, well, they've had the same guy, really great actor named Nick Jameson, had been voicing Palpatine for a long time, and that was Dara's casting. Mm. And I just didn't know if they'd be open to it. And so I was just trying to temper your expectations in case it didn't happen. Yeah. So the lead in our game wasn't like,
what the hell?
Just flipping over tables.
I was going to be Palpatine!
but your face is on the
I don't care! It's not enough! It's never enough!
The thirst for Star Wars is insatiable.
Well, the thirst for power. I was power mad.
Yes.
I was just like, fine. That's why I was perfect for Palpatine, because I'm like, I love the power. Okay, see, now I'm getting cocky because I came in with health. This is not the way to play this game.
Good old Force Lightning.
It's at least it's reliable, right? Like,
I have to give huge credit, of course, to Matthew Wood and Ben Burt on this stuff, because, you know, a lot of the stuff, like the Force Lightning and sound designer Tom Bible, like the basis of the Force Lightning was really a lot of stuff from Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith, and then we added some really sort of transient explosions at the top to make it really amped up, and then Tom Bible did a great job of, like, leveling it, so there were different sounds for level 1, 2, 3, etc. A lot of this stuff, a lot about doing Star Wars is being true to the movies and removing your ego out of the process and just being like, well, actually, no. Nothing sounds cooler than the movie, so rather than try and make something better, like, just use that sound, protect it, and maybe embellish it when the gameplay requires it, but it's got to be the heart of that sound.
I will never remove my ego from the process, David. Never.
Well.
Never.
I mean as a sound editor.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, sound designer.
Well, maybe it's good if you should remove your ego from the process, definitely.
Yeah, definitely.
Me, though, no.
Except for when I'm on the mic, then I'm just going to,
Yeah. Well, you know, we both stole parts in this game, you know?
Yes. I did all the Felucians in this game, too.
Did
I
was you really?
All that kind of stuff, you know, pitched it down and combined it with some other sound effects. And oh, just throughout the years, there were so many voices that happened. Just because it was, you know, I don't know, it's how my whole voiceover career started was working
That's
in
right,
games.
And now you have a thriving voiceover career.
Yeah.
Among many other careers that you have.
No, please.
Yeah, I guess in a lot of ways my career is kind of like proxy. It's like it just is always taking on a different... I'm composing. No, I'm a sound designer. No, I'm a voice actor. No, I'm a celebration host.
This
I'm
is
a,
really...
It's really hard.
Happening to me. Okay, here we go. Here we go.
Good job.
Sort
this
of.
This is it. This is it. You've got this, Master.
I guess so.
Don't be worried about what he's about to do now!
Jump!
Jump.
Jump.
Yes!
Boom.
So we'll play this cutscene and then we will...
We'll wrap it for the day.
We'll answer a few more questions.
Oh, yeah.
After this...
a few more.
So, if you have any questions that we've missed, now is the time. Cue them up. And then we'll call them.
Let's see. Just remind me where he is. Awesome. Don't get cocky.
Juno.
Can we get a power unlimited power? Oh, you'd have to back off on the mic.
Unlimited power.
as Miss Piggy, or what was that?
Well, yeah.
Oh, this is interesting.
Oh, I love this cutscene.
There's an interesting.
We should watch this cutscene.
Because there's things to say about it.
He's doing something he shouldn't be doing.
That's right. This is cheating. He's cheating on his master right now.
My master, Kazdan Paradis, is dead.
Then there is but one more test.
Yeah, just a little dirt in there, because that's
ready
actually
now.
Proxy.
No. You've defeated an old man.
Acting as a radio.
Outcast. You must face a true Jedi master.
Who?
Master Shaak Ti. One of the last of the Jedi Council. will need the full power of the dark side to defeat her.
Yes, my master.
Adrian Wilkinson, and Susan Eisenberg, also Wonder Woman from Justice League.
Darth Vader has found us.
Incredible voice.
Maris, gather your belongings and go into hiding, just as we've practiced.
Do and not Susan and I all did a radio drama together for a series called Suspense.
This is what I've been waiting for.
We did an episode called The Night Reveals.
No. I will lead this assassin to the ancient abyss.
It's fun to have the three of us in the booth.
You are not
together,
ready to face a Sith. You would surely be killed. Maris, we are among the last of the Jedi. While we live, the Order survives. I cannot allow you to be captured or killed by the Empire. Now please.
Drastically different costume there for Shaak Ti than what we saw in episode 3.
Big time, yeah.
And I love these Felucians here.
No. She hasn't been corrupted. Not yet. She's just afraid.
Great animation on Shaak Ti.
May the Force be with you, Maris Brood.
Cool.
So,
questions. Preguntas?
I'm tracking your location. Just ahead, you should find a hollow fungus tower. You'll need to make your way through it.
So, didn't Shaak Ti die by the hands of Grievous?
That was in the Ganon...
She was gonna get killed in the Gendi series, but then they had to redo it because George is like, no, I'm gonna kill her in episode 3. Then they killed her in episode 3, but then they deleted that scene, so she was back in canon, so then we finally killed her off in The Force Unleashed.
Right.
But The Force Unleashed isn't really canon anymore, so I don't know, is she alive?
She settled down.
Oh, she did.
She had 3 kids, but then she had a divorce.
Oh, yeah,
she was going through the whole divorce thing for a while.
Yeah. I think she's working in real estate now. Is that right?
She got her real estate license.
Mm-hmm.
And then so she's fine. She's doing actually a lot better since she's recovered from the divorce. She's dating a great guy.
Oh, good.
Really, really cool guy.
Yeah, was that Carl?
Carl.
Yeah.
But Steve was no good for her.
Steve was a jerk.
From the beginning, we knew that was not the guy to marry.
Well, yeah. I mean, he convinced her to wear that Felucian outfit way longer than...
Not
cool. Look at how young we were in those pictures.
I know.
Good Lord. Well, this has been
Dara
fun.
O'Farrell right there. And then there's Hayden Blackman and...
Cully, right?
Matt O.
Oh, is that Matt O?
No, that's Cully. It's Cully. You're right. Cully Fredrickson. Practicing getting blinded.
Some cool concept art.
Were either of us involved in the canceled Darth Maul game?
I was not.
And I was almost. was the character in TFU2 truly a clone or was it a lie? The problem with answering questions about stuff like that is that what if they want to do something with that stuff?
Yeah.
Like we can't.
We don't know, really.
I actually know.
Oh.
Do you not? You know that.
About
you know?
Which part?
About whether he was a clone or not? And what
I thought you said about a sequel.
No,
about
no,
whether he was a clone or not. Yeah, we don't want to say.
And what other questions? When are they going to bring Starkiller into canon? Next week, Tuesday, I believe.
Tuesday. Where, there's no episode that airs Tuesday, but
that's when.
We're deciding that
he's going to be canon.
Yeah, I don't know.
You could do the make them regenerate. What is this both? Is there anything in the new movies that you would make them? Here, if you can phrase your questions smallly, because it moves a lot.
It moves so fast.
Okay, do you like concise. Darth Revan or Jedi Revan more? I was a Jedi Revan when I played Knights of the Republic. I that's how I played it. Did you play Knights of the Republic, David?
I did, but I remember recording a line that was like, all hail Lord Revan, with a giant group of people for that game.
Is that right?
So before I ever got to it, I knew the ending. So I don't think I ever actually played the ending.
Yeah, you didn't. You were spoiled pretty
heavily.
I was spoiled.
Yeah.
Are there any levels cut from the final game?
Yes. There was going to be like a crystal planet.
Really?
Was there? Mm-hmm. Wow. But this was really early on. There was going to be a crystal planet, I remember, that got cut. Are there other levels? That's all I remember, though.
The crystal planet. Well, there was, and there were certainly cutscenes.
There was this idea that there was going to be some giant core like a MCP thing that Proxy had sort of become.
That's right. The core on Raxus Prime.
And that somehow Proxy lost his mind, and then Hayden totally simplified that whole plot into, well, no, actually, it's just more interesting if Proxy just tries to complete his programming and let's make him Darth Maul.
That's right. That's right. So Proxy was going to kill you because the core took him over, and then Hayden decided, no, it's better if...
Let's just Proxy be Proxy.
In the original version of the script, Proxy was trying to kill you like 3 times more than he did in the actual game. Mm-hmm. Like he was constantly turning into other Jedi that we'd seen in the movies and the TV shows and stuff and trying to kill you.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And the most compelling was when he turned into Anakin Skywalker. Do you remember that? There was a scene where he walks in and we indicate that Starkiller does not know this Jedi, and he goes, oh, a new one, huh? All right,
yes, well. I do remember that now.
And Starkiller goes, all right, bring it on, Proxy, that's fine. And the camera pans over and we realize it's Anakin Skywalker. And that's when you and I had a huge geek discussion. We're like, well, then that means that Vader built Proxy, because who would have known about Anakin Skywalker or thought it was important to program him in except Vader?
Mm. And yeah, we never revealed, but given his mechanical nature and that he built 3PO, it made sense that Vader built Proxy, but it's never actually explained.
Exactly.
Hayden would never answer that question.
But we surmised that because of the inclusion of Anakin Skywalker, and then we started geeking out, being like, but Vader would have tested this Proxy unit, so... We had these visions of Darth Vader fighting Anakin Skywalker.
Yeah.
You know, we just...
Here's a good one. Being a big Star Wars fan, how was it being involved in Star Wars?
Oh, God. I mean, when I got hired, I was hearing Star Wars music in my head for like 2 weeks straight. Like, you know, when you get a song stuck in your head, it was like that, except it was John Williams for 2 weeks.
I remember you would come and visit and you would just hang out. Mm-hmm. Like you'd come to meetings and you just would, you know, you just hang out and you befriended the entire team. And
yeah.
I remember Cully bringing like food. Do you remember this?
No.
He brought like pastries and snacks to the team and stuff. Yeah.
Cully, by the way, who played General Coda? Cully Fredrickson. You should IMDb him. He was, he also played the first Vulcan to land and meet Zefram Cochrane in the movie Star Trek First Contact.
Mm-hmm. He said, live long and prosper. Now that you know that, you'll see that movie and you'll just hear General Coda's
General
voice.
General Coda. Live long and prosper.
Boy. Star Wars: The Force Unleashed drinking game. Every time he says "boy," take a shot.
Take a shot.
Oh, you're done with. I remember it was a massive crunch for us. It was probably a 6 to 9 month crunch at the end, and just going nuts. And I was mixing late into the night, and Sam would just call me and just put on speakerphone. How you doing, man? You doing all right? And I'd be like, oh,
yeah,
I'm so tired. He's like, keep going, dude. This is gonna be so awesome. It's gonna be so great. I'm gonna be up there next week. We'll have a good time. Blah blah. You know, and that made a big difference. I mean, it made a big difference to have the lead of the show be so into it and so passionate about it. Because there's you and EJ, also known as Batman from Bat Kid.
Right, EJ.
Go rent Bat Kid Begins. EJ, who worked at ILM in R&D, is actually Batman from the famous Bat Kid story. He did that whole thing with Make-A-Wish. But anyway, it made a huge difference to have someone be such a cheerleader and fan of Star Wars, because everyone was excited. Everyone was excited when you did the press junket. People could feel that you were excited, you know. Mm. Made a huge difference.
It was a lot of fun. Do I think that joy or laughter could fuel the dark side? Yeah, I think a lot of emotions, if they're left unchecked and used for different purposes. I mean, take Palpatine. He has a great sense of humor. And that was the big thing. That's kind of why I wanted to do him for Force Unleashed, because I didn't feel like people who did Palpatine understood that he was actually a funny guy.
Mm-hmm. You know, oh, I'm afraid the deflector shield will be quite operational.
You know, he's like, he's playing with Luke and he's, you know, he laughs a lot. He's a happy guy. I mean, probably not, but he does laugh a lot.
What did you think of the Old Republic era mythos from the online?
I thought it was great. I played it a little bit, but I need to play more of it. But yeah, it's interesting. It's so far back that who's to say that they're wrong? Starkiller was overpowered. And again, we talked about this earlier in the cast. We considered Starkiller, I looked at it like it was a tall tale, that maybe he didn't pull the Star Destroyer out of the sky, that something happened with that Star Destroyer and maybe he had some hand in it. But the legend goes that he used the Force to yank it out of the sky. Because ultimately, this is a video game, right? So, and the idea of the video game was to amp up the Force to 11, which, if we were doing a movie of Force Unleashed, I don't think that we would go that. We wouldn't go half as far. He wouldn't kill 100 stormtroopers scene. Having said that, though, you know, like the script and the story were thematically totally on point. I believe Hayden Blackman
killed it.
Well, yeah, you have to consider your medium. You brought this up before. You know, I remember.
Yeah, Clone Wars. Like, you know, if you cast Ahsoka Tano in a live action, she's not going to be as quick or do as many flips because it's not animated. It's not.
Yeah, and you gotta do fantasy fulfillment in a video game, right? Yeah, you have to be able to just show people something they've never seen before. And that was the whole idea, was to do something really, really fun and unique with Star Wars, but also give it a great story. I remember walking out of Jurassic Park with Patrick, and Patrick had read the book. It's a brilliant book, by the way, Michael Crichton. But he didn't enjoy the movie as much as I did. I was blown away by the movie. But he was thinking so much about the book, you know, and why didn't they do this? Why did they change this? And
I had the same thing with Jurassic
Park. And so it was almost like we saw two different movies, you know. I later read the book and I'm like, oh, now I get it. But it was a real lesson for me in the difference in mediums, you know, that the Force Unleashed, having those Force powers for a game works. If you were to pop that into the Clone Wars or Rebels, I think it really creates a balance problem. Although the character would be great to see that character sort of in maybe a slightly different permutation or something. But I feel like we're already kind of seeing that.
Well, yeah, they sort of, you when know? You look at Rebels, you think about like, they're dealing with the same themes and a lot of the same ideas. Like, for example, Force Unleashed is a smaller story. Rebels is an ongoing series, right? So we had the Inquisitor character and the Kanan character and a little bit of the Ezra character are all one character in Force Unleashed. Mm-hmm. Starkiller is basically, you know, he takes the role of an Imperial Inquisitor. He hunts down the Jedi for Darth Vader. Mm-hmm. He also is a Han Solo-like Jedi.
Yeah.
And he's also sort of a kid who was, you know, kind of an orphan. Mm. So it's interesting that these ideas, they pop up in other ways. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I'm not going to say what, but like there are things that happen in Rebels coming up that are, you know, either nods to Force Unleashed or they're complete coincidences. Mm. So
I remember loving in the Clone Wars seeing Clancy Brown's character, Savage Opress, do a Force repulse in one of his first action scenes. And I was like, oh, Force Unleashed. But I mean, the whole Force Unleashed team, a lot of that team went up to Lucasfilm Animation to end up working on Clone Wars and Rebels. Mm-hmm. And so it's just, you know, it's nice to see those ideas kind of continued, and it's very flattering.
Yeah, Force Unleashed was how I got involved with the Lucasfilm Animation people.
Yeah, there'd be no Darth Maul, you know, as we know it without Force Unleashed.
Yeah, basically what, you know, at the time, at least my interpretation of events is this, that Force Unleashed and Rebels both came out at the same... Rebels. Force Unleashed and Clone Wars both came out at the same time. And at the time that Clone Wars came out, Clone Wars was really kind of a kid's show. And it was kind of catering to the younger fans. Whereas Force Unleashed was for the older fans. And it had a little bit more mature content. And we had, you know, we were in the classic trilogy rather than the original trilogy. So we were all about the older fans. They were about the younger fans. And basically around season three, when they started Clone Wars got older and more mature. So it started catering more toward the older fans. And my theory is that's why David Filoni wanted me and Adrian Wilkinson, who played Maris Brood,
for the Mortis trilogy.
There she is. To come in and play the son and the daughter in the Mortis trilogy.
Which was also very flattering.
Yeah.
Him bringing, you know, you guys in. Hey, Leonard.
Hey, Leonard. Hi, buddy.
Hey, buddy. What's up, dude?
Hey, pal.
Here he comes.
We're talking about the Force, bud.
So the theory I always had was that he knew that his show was starting to cater to the adult Star Wars fans, and he wanted to sort of bring the Force Unleashed fans over to Clone Wars, saying like, "No, we're ready for you guys now. Mm-hmm. We're now," because the beautiful thing about Clone Wars is it did start as a kid's show, but then they aged the show with the generation of kids that grew up with it. So that the kids who were 8 years old by season four, they're 12, and if you want to keep them with the show, you have to make the show more sophisticated in terms of its content. So that's why Clone Wars, by the time it gets to season six, it's like, I mean, it's the Empire Strikes Back. It's every bit as sophisticated. It's really a tremendous show. Did we miss any other great questions?
Yeah, we got a couple.
What happened to Maris Brood? What did she do?
We don't know.
We don't know.
She ran. She was let go, and she ran off. So I'm sure there's a great story there that could show up. That's a character that had an open-ended. Yeah, because you let her go.
That's right.
Yeah, we don't know what happened to Maris Brood.
Yeah.
And, you know, we don't know what happened to Juno, really, for that matter, or Starkiller, or Proxy, or any of us. Ah, we don't know. We don't know.
We don't know what happened to Vader after he was taken captive.
Yeah, he was taken captive.
Yeah.
Different commentary.
Thing. Yeah, different
commentary. This has been really fun.
You guys have been really, thank you so much for tuning in, and we're going to do this again, and we're going to, right now, we are talking to two major members of the dev team who want to join us, so we're going to get them on Skype and do episode 2 of the developer commentary and continue our playthrough of Force Unleashed. So,
yeah.
So we're going to have a lot of other things to say about this this project. So thank you so much for tuning in, ladies and gentlemen. This was a lot of fun.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
See you next time.
May the Force be with you.
The Force will be with you. Oh.